The writer, the Southern writer, William Faulkner, once put it, "Between grief and nothing, I will take grief." And it is that collective sense of mourning that unites the racing community here at Talladega Super Speedway. It was here that one of racing's best, Davey Allison, drove his first Winston Cup race. He won his first major race here. On July 12th, piloting his own helicopter, he crashed at this racetrack in the infield. Davey would die the next day. He was 32. He was a husband and a father of two. He was the son of legendary driver Bobby, the brother of another racer, Clifford, who also lost his life on a racetrack just last year. Hello, everyone. I'm Ken Squire at Talladega, Alabama. And yes, there will be a race today. And yes, we will see the likes of Earnhardt, Elliott, and 40 others dueling for 500 miles. But first, this track, this racing family, will pause to remember Davey Allison, a racer from Alabama, a man who meant so much to so many. Ladies and gentlemen, we direct your attention trackside now, where the next words you hear will be those of the Reverend Hal Marchman.
We are happy that you're here this memorable day when the racing fans of Davey Allison, his family of NASCAR, all of the people in the garage area and the pit crews and his loved ones are here to pay tribute to Dave and recognize his accomplishments and his exceptional character. We remember and pray for his family. He said his family was his first priority, and he said that NASCAR was his family. We remember his mother, Judy, and his father, Bobby, who are not with us today. We remember his sisters, Carrie and Bonnie, who are with us today. We remember the Alabama gang that was so important to him. And we remember his mentor and his dear friend, Red Farmer. We're here today with those nearest and dearest to Davey's heart, and they are on the stand with me. Davey's wife, Liz, his daughter, Christy, and his son, Robbie. His two sisters are also here with us, Carrie and Bonnie. Liz wants to speak to you today. And Liz, we know this is a difficult time for you, but we sure are glad you're here. God bless you.
The last 2 weeks have been really difficult for Robbie, Krista, and myself, and the whole Allison family. There have been times that we felt that we couldn't go on. The love and the support that all of the fans have shown to all of us has been just overwhelming. There's no way that we can ever thank each and every one of you for that love. I know that now we can all hold on to the memories of Davey and to try to go on with our lives. Davey's looking down on us today with a big smile on his face. He would be so proud of the love that you have shown to him and to his family. These are all the things that will help Robbie and Krista know how very special their daddy was to so many people. And there's something that I'd like to share with all of you today that's brought some peace to me, and I hope that it will to you. Please don't sing sad songs for me. Forget your grief and fears. For I am in a perfect place, away from pain and tears. I'm far away from hunger and hurt and want and pride. I have a place in heaven with the Master at my side. My life on earth was very good as earthly lives can go, but paradise is so much more than anyone can know. My heart is filled with happiness and sweet rejoicing too. To walk with God is perfect peace, a joy forever new. Thank you all very much. God bless you.
God bless you, Liz, and your family. And every history book on stock car racing will include Davy Allison, a top contender and a great sportsman. We loved you, Davy. You were our son, our brother, and our hero. And now I can almost hear Davy say, "That's enough. Get on with the race." And you race fans have fun. And will you join me in prayer? Almighty God, we thank you today for Davy's life, for his charisma, for the inspiration he was to all of us. He would not fail today to have us ask you to bless all of those who are involved in this race today on his home track. Hear us, Lord, as we all pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and shalom. Now let us hear the musical group Alabama express their feelings for Davy by singing "The Fan."
Toured the concert halls, we survived our share of bar rooms, stared at many motel walls. The years in Carolina and all the one night stands, what kept the fires a-burning back then was you, the fans. We two stepped out to Texas, round and round the dance hall floor, played the fair in Minnesota. I wish we could have played one more. We hope you remember, we're just the boys in the band, and what keeps the fires a-burning is always you, the fans. I wish this night could last forever. Ah, but the show must go on. We'll take home the memories, and we'll leave with our songs. It's been good to see y'all. Can we come back again and again and again? What keeps the fires a-burning in us is you, the fans. keep the fires a-burning for all of you, our fans.
CBS Sports presents the Die Hard 500, sponsored by Die Hard, the official battery of NASCAR. Ford and your Ford dealer, have you driven a Ford lately? And by Goodyear, number one in tires.
And so now the show must go on, and some racing questions are to be answered, especially for Bill Elliott. This superstar has not led a lap all season. Today, he sits on the pole. Is the slump over? For Dale Earnhardt, the question is, will he maintain that big lead in the race for Driver of the Year? For Neil Bonnett, the question, how will he do in his return after being out of commission for 3 years? And for Robbie Gordon, how will he do driving in the shadow of Davey Allison? Questions. A lot to be asked today at Talladega. Answers are set to unfold in this hot, scorching, record-setting heat.
Joined by my colleague, Ned Jarrett. Ned, this is always an event of high intensity, but I can't ever recall in all those races since 1969 a time where there has been such an emotional level and a record crowd here today. And of course, the heat a factor, where they've had a record-breaking heat every day as we settle down for this 500-mile event.
Well, the heat certainly will be a factor today in this race, Ken. And yes, the emotions have been very high. They're always high when we come to the Talladega Super Speedway because of the intense competition and the high speeds they run here. But then everyone's mind has been on Davey Allison and their family this week. And certainly our prayers continue to go out to Liz, the children, Bobby, Judy, and the entire Allison family. But life goes on, and if life goes on, the race goes on, and no one would want us to race any more than Davey Allison. That's the way he would want everyone here doing their absolute best. So this race will go on today, and yes, there are a lot of things in this race that are going to make it very interesting. How about the emotions and the pressure on 24-year-old Robbie Gordon, who was named to drive the Robert Yates car number 28, which Davey Allison has driven so successfully over the years. Now, Robbie Gordon comes to us with some very impressive credentials. He has won in just about every form of competition he has raced in since he was a kid, but he has very little experience in stock cars. Can he handle the draft? Yesterday afternoon in practice, they were giving him some pretty good lessons out there. They were passing him high and passing him low and giving him something to think about overnight. He's a very talented young man. It'll be interesting to see how he does handle it. And then our colleague Neil Bonnett, choosing the hottest day we've had in years at a stock car race to come and make his comeback. He wants to have some fun out here today, but one thing that he does not want to do, and that is to interfere with anyone else out there or harm anyone that might be running for points. And we just hope that his concern for his fellow drivers won't take away too much from his natural aggressive style. But I think Neil's going to do okay.
We're just about ready for the command to fire them up and get underway here. So let's go down now for the command. Gene Stallings, the head coach of the Crimson Tide from the University of Alabama, the national football champions, about to make the key call of the day.
And now to introduce to you this afternoon the grand marshal for today's race, the coach for the Alabama Crimson Tide, Mr. Gene Stallings.
Drivers, start your engines.
How's that sound with the motor running, Bobby?
Give me a little. I know CBS is listening or whatever.
All ready. How's that sound, Bobby? Good. Give me one more time.
Let's go down to Mike Joy right now and get more on the heat story here at Talladega as we prepare for the Die Hard 500. Mike?
Well, Ken, these cars are designed to cheat the wind, not get air to the driver. This motor pumps out intense heat. The windshield, the sun bakes in just like it does when you park your car at the mall all day. The side window on the right side is closed. That flat back window takes in a lot of sunlight and with it a lot of heat. Before Ernie Irvin fired his engine, it was 114 degrees inside this car. But the drivers have ways to cope with this heat. David Hobbs shows us how.
Mike, as you say, these cars are just one 3,500-pound heat sink, and a lot of that heat comes off the engine through the floor and the driver's feet to help combat it. We've got fiberglass Kevlar matting, a bit of space-age material here. That cuts down that heat a lot. They take in air off the skin of the car in this NACA duct, comes down this insulated tube to the air pump. The pipe size drops, increases the velocity, and it goes through this heat exchanger. This ice box is full of ice, and of course the air, when it comes out the other side, is really nice and cool. And it goes round this pipe into the driver's helmet and puts super cold air around the driver's head. Some of them have a V in this pipe to help cool the back of the seat as well. This is another insulated pipe to extract hot air out of the car. And of course, these drivers are going to lose somewhere in the region of 2 liters of water or fluid an hour. And this box here is going to fill them up with them, as apart from their fuel stops as well. So it's going to be a real hot day. And in spite of all this equipment, those drivers are going to get just awfully, awfully hot this afternoon.
And David, these black cars are about 10 degrees hotter than the other ones. Black absorbs heat. Kyle Petty says he may lose as much as 12 pounds today. He wears a size 34 waist in his pants. He brings a pair of drawstring pants with him to Talladega and says he'll cinch him up about 2 inches tighter to cover what he'll lose in water weight today. The 42 cars that'll start the Die Hard 500 are rolling past for the first of the pace laps. Go upstairs to Ken Squire with the starting grid for today's race.
Row one features Bill Elliott on the pole for the first time in 93 and the Die Hard champ from a year ago, Ernie Irvin. Row two, it's Brett Bodine and Kyle Petty. In row three, Ricky Rudd, winner at Michigan on CBS, and Rick Mass. Row four is Greg Sachs and the rookie sensation, Jeff Gordon. Row five, it's Hutch Strickland and Rick Wilson. In row six, the four-time winner of the Die Hard 500, Dale Earnhardt and Harry Gantt. Row seven is Michael Waltrip and Robbie Gordon. Row eight, Dale Jarrett, and the two-time winner here, Darrell Waltrip. In row nine, it's Jimmy Means and Boy Allen Jr. Row 10 is Jimmy Hensley and Neil Bonnet. Row 11, Ted Musgrave and Sterling Marlin. For row 12, Morgan Shepherd and Jimmy Horton. Row 13, Mark Martin and Wally Gollenbach Jr. Row 14 is Jimmy Spencer and Ken Schrader. Row 15, the 86th champion of this event, Bobby Hillen and Jeff Purvis. Row 16 is Derek Cope and Rusty Wallace. In row 17, Jeff Bodine is there with Kenny Wallace. Row 18, Alabama's Stanley Smith and the 89 winner, Terry Labonte. Row 19, Bill Parsons and Dick Trickle. Richard Petty's nephew, Richie Petty, is on the inside of row 20, and there's Lake Speed. The provisional starters in row 21 are Bobby Labonte and the 76th Die Hard 500 champion, Dave Marcus.
Back with you at Talladega Super Speedway. In-car cameras today, Dale Earnhardt, Jimmy Spencer, and Neil Bonnet back at the helm after 3 years absent, and we're going to be able to talk to Neil during the race. Neil, how do you hear us down there? Let's see if we can get Neil Bonnet again. Hello, Neil.
CBS
Control.
Neil.
You read us.
Well, Neil's concentrating so hard there that the parent is not paying any attention to anything on the outside. Neil, are you hearing us now?
I can hear you now.
Okay, how are things looking?
Looks good. Everything looks good. Boy, what a sight. All the people with the Davey Allison banners up. An opportunity for me to go back racing like this. It's kind of mixed emotions, but we're going to see what we can do here. It's going to be a lot of fun.
How do you feel about doing some commentary during the race today, Neil?
We'll see what we can do with it.
All right.
Hopefully we give the
good
people
luck.
Another look at this side of racing.
All right.
We're fixing to have a lot of fun. We'll see if we can take the people along for the ride.
So he's been saying all week, fixing to have some fun. He'll be starting back there in that 20th position. Field getting set for a start.
Ken, I'm sure the fans were wondering, as we look inside of Dale Earnhardt's car, who will be carrying one of the cameras, saw that little white piece of tape on the top of the steering wheel on Neil's car. That is to identify that the steering wheel is straight up and down and his wheels are running straight. That's just an identification piece of tape.
Earnhardt in the 11th position. Jimmy Spencer also carrying an onboard camera as we settle down for a start. Very, very humid. A lot of overcast here. Field moving through the trioval. Remember at Talladega, the finish line several hundred feet out of the trioval toward turn number one.
And the green flag waves.
Bill Elliott, who this morning changed everything, motor, transmission, driveline, all the way through, trying to remedy what they thought was a problem on car number 11, the pole sitter at 192 miles per hour.
See them panning out four, five abreast down the backstretch as they get their speed up. It takes them at least a full lap to get their full speed up with the restrictor plates they run on the cars here at Talladega.
Remember in May, they ran them three wide, some 20 laps in the course of that event.
Very nerve-wracking situation, especially for a day, unfortunately. It was for everyone.
Coming to over 190 miles per hour, approaching the 18-degree trioval, and here they come back with Elliott and Irvin locked up in front. In fact, the entire field has barely moved to position, except Bonnet's trying to go right up the middle there in car number 31. Back on the 31-degree banking. It's Bill Elliott on the bottom side. Best finish of the season 1 week ago. Pocono, Pennsylvania. In Neil Bonnet's car. Talk about tight running at 190. Inches apart. Neil Bonnet's number 31, fading back about three positions. Hutch Strickland getting around him. Rick Wilson up on the outside, Gant right behind him. Jeff Purvis right there. A wash of sound as they come down out of the trioval and thunder into turn number one. Ernie Irvin going for the lead.
Ernie Irvin led that lap, but Bill Elliott led the first lap, Ken, and that was the first lap in 1993 that Bill Elliott has led in the Junior Johnson Ford.
Took him 18 races to lead a lap. He's there now fighting with a man who's won three out of the last four on this track. Ernie Irvin, who loves to go fast. Look at him flying, down the back straightaway. Coming by to complete lap number three of 188. They stack them three wide for second spot.
Brent Bodine pulls down on the inside, trying to draft on past Bill Elliott, and he does it. Now Ricky Rudd coming down to the inside for the burst of speed.
Give it to Irvin. Kyle Petty goes to second. Rick Mast is up to third, but here comes Rudd on the inside.
And Bill Elliott has been caught in the middle. He's going backwards now. He just simply can't get the draft off of anyone. He doesn't want to stay in that position very long.
At over 190 miles an hour, 42 racers locked together, less than 2 seconds apart. Elliott falling back to 14th. Morgan Shepherd on the move, coming up for the point. It's the Morgan McClure, Ernie Irvin, number four.
There's Neil Bonnet in the black number 31. Now we're looking at his windshield as he drafts on Bobby Hillen, the car number 90 in front of him.
Bonnet back in 21st, started 20th. This is for turn one. Jeff Gordon, number 24, the 21-year-old sensation from Pittsburgh, Indiana, goes into fourth spot.
Last lap, almost 194 miles an hour. Faster than they qualified. Not surprising, though, in the draft.
And lined up like they would be at a traffic light. Around to complete lap number five. Irvin staying out in front.
has an awfully fast car. Of course, he qualified on the outside pole, but yesterday in practice, he was absolutely one of the fastest.
Kyle Petty, who dominated the event on this track in May. They ran 500 miles. Kyle was phenomenal that day in the Felix of Venice, car number 42. Just eases up toward the wall. Right on the edge of out of control.
There's Ricky Rudd caught down on the inside by himself with no one to draft with, but he's hanging on pretty good there. That's the five car for Chevrolet.
Michael Waltrip is up to fifth, Rudd back to sixth. Waltrip is in seventh. Greg Sachs having a good run, he's in eighth. Hutch Strickland from Alabama in ninth. Earnhardt is 10th. Earnhardt won yesterday in one of the most dramatic Grand National races I've seen in years. Last year, Ernie Irvin won on Saturday, came back and won on Sunday. Can he do it here? Earnhardt in 10th, working on Greg Sachs right in front of him. Headed for turn one. Out the back. There you see Richard Petty's car. Rick Wilson out of Bartow, Florida at the controls. And look at those cars just weave, Ned.
Yeah, they can't. It's hard to hold them on a straight line because of the air off the other cars. It's just impossible to get stable air so that you can hold them in a straight line.
And the air off that outside concrete wall.
Yes.
You have to correct for that all the time or it's good nightmares. Again, the last lap. Lap five was over 194 miles an hour. Hillen is on the move. He's come from 29th. Bobby Hillen out of Midland, Texas, from 29th to 13th. Irvin stays first. Kyle Petty second. Rockbridge Baths, Virginia. Rick Mast looking strong in third. Then there's the youngster. Had that great run at Daytona. Jeff Gordon stays fourth. Finished fifth out there in the Daytona 500 this year.
Wow.
Riding a wide to the trial.
Earnhardt was just way up in what they call the marbles. However, they're normally on this racetrack, there's not much loose stuff that gets up on top of the track, so they can run just right up next to the wall.
A report from Mike Joy.
Ken Pulsitter, Bill Elliott's team this morning changed transmissions twice. The drive shaft and the rear end to cure a vibration problem. They have conquered it. Elliott started on the pole and said they'd just been shuffled back in the pack due to the draft. Just pack racing. That's put him back in mid-pack.
Trying to get sorted out. Bill Elliott, he sat on the pole yesterday, sat on the pole today. Things are getting better. He had a third place finish a week ago at Pocono, Pennsylvania. But it's not the old Junior Johnson or the old Billion. Now there's the 28 car to get to the roll.
Bobby Gordon trying to pass on the inside. He's currently back in 30th position. He has dropped back a little bit trying to, well, we're showing 27th on the screen there. Just trying to get the feel of the draft.
Wise move on his part.
Yes.
This is not a track in this kind of a draft where you want to be mixing it up if you really don't know where to plant your feet.
He has a very fast race car, one of, if not the fastest car in the field, but drafting experience is so critical.
There's Dick Trickle up the outside.
And the rookie driver, Kenny Wallace, in car number 40.
Back with the leaders, Ernie Irvin, Kyle Petty, Rick Mast, and Jeff Gordon. One, two, three, four. Give fifth to Michael Waltrip, who stays right in there. The diehard 500 from Talladega Super Speedway. We'll continue after this message and a word from your local station. CBS bringing you coverage of the diehard 500, 25th annual here in Talladega, Alabama. And that's how they are running through 11 laps. Top 10, but actually the top 25 are together, and right now they're switching positions going down through the first and second turn.
Yeah, the rookie driver, Jeff Gordon, just took the lead going into turn one, but he went very high. Now Ernie Irvin coming back on the inside of him. There's Dale Earnhardt already up to third. He's going for the lead.
Three wide in the three. and number three takes the lead.
Earnhardt has not led in this race so far. Of course, we're early in the race, but he wants to get 5 bonus points for leading a lap.
Dale Earnhardt's number three, sticking like a cat on Velcro as it rolls down to the bottom of that corner. Here he comes from the tri-oval, and look at this gang gathering behind him. There's Earnhardt just in front. Earnhardt has said you'll be leading this race and think you're sitting pretty. Then you'll look in your rear mirror and it looks like a team picture. That's what he's seeing right now.
You can look in that rear view mirror and see a lot of hungry drivers back there, that's for sure. And look at this rookie Jeff Gordon. What a great year he has had so far. And just running right up front with the guys who have been there for years and years. Here's the other Gordon. That's Robbie Gordon.
Falling back to 33rd. Lake Speed just going around in there. Look at that 21 car. That's Morgan Shepherd. Wow, he's come from 23rd to 8th. Morgan Shepherd in the Wood Brothers car. The Wood Brothers have won this race just once. 1980, the driver, the great Neil Bonner.
Morgan Shepherd is a master at drafting, and certainly the Wood Brothers know how to set a car up for drafting. Here's a group of cars down on the inside trying to make a move. Ernie Irvin got hung out down there by himself. So now he has some cars coming up behind him. Rick Mastin, the car number one, Darrell Waltrip, Dale Jarrett, Derek Cope, and Bobby Hillen all trying that inside groove now to try to make a move. Here's one way to try.
Neil Bonnet. 22nd position here. Closing up on Jimmy Spencer in the Bobby Allison car number 12. He's within striking distance, about a second back from the leaders. There you see Jeff Bodine streaking down the inside and going by both Bonnet and Spencer. This is in turn one and two. And here comes Robbie Gordon picking up a spot or two. Here's David Hans.
I'm with Larry McClure, owner of Ernie Irvin's car. He's just slipped back a little bit in the pack, but otherwise looking pretty good for that third win.
Well, the Kodak Film Delco Remy Chevrolet's looking real good today. We're just riding along. I tell you, these guys are trying to test us to see how strong we are, and of course we're trying to test and see what they're going to do. So we're just going to ride and see what happens here. We'd like to say hello to Tony Glover today. He's not with us. His mother passed away.
Ernie had a bit of a ride yesterday afternoon. He's not hurting at all, is he, from that?
Yeah, he's okay. He's a little sore this morning, but other than that, he's okay.
Of course, Tony.
Okay, thank you.
Tony Glover that he spoke of there is the crew chief on that car, and certainly our condolences go out to he and his family.
On the Ernie Irvin car, Ernie took the wildest ride of the weekend yesterday on the last lap of that 500K Grand National race. Show you some of that. Take a look at the last lap yesterday here at Talladega in the Grand National race. This was coming for the finish. We'll get to it in a moment here. So watch Earnhardt still in front. This is the last lap. There goes Ernie. He has to be the most religious person here because he sure had the right saint that time. Why he didn't roll about 20 times, we'll never know, huh, Ned?
Well, it was a miracle. The car just had to be in the right position. The air had to pick him up just right and set him down just right.
Earnhardt came home the winner yesterday. Norwalk, Connecticut native Randy LaJoy had an incredible second place, came from 8th to 2nd in the last moments of the race, and Terry Labonte had a fine finish for 3rd. That was in yesterday's 117 lap event, something like that. Well, now today we're settling down for 188 laps, of which 18 are now complete. 47 miles are down as they continue to run this very tight draft and this giant freight train into the tri-oval.
And there are 34 cars in that lead draft. There were only 42 started this race. A couple of cars not too far in front of the leaders are Sterling Marlin and Jimmy Hensley. They either lost the draft or have a problem with their cars. Anyway, they're just about to go a lap down.
The Kent Schrader car is on the move. It's from 25th up to 8th position. Riding with the leader, Earnhardt, back straight away. Young Gordon right with him, and here comes Waltrip on the inside.
Darrell has just picked off one car and then the other, trying to get up towards the front. He has tried the high, he has tried the low. Now he's on the low side of Ernie Irvin. Doesn't have anyone to draft with down there. That's a tough go when you try to go by yourself. But look, when those two cars get side by side, Evans Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon are able to pull away. They look up in their rear view mirror and say, boy, we hope they race side by side for a while, because that lets us go. But here they're going to make it three abreast. Here comes Bill Elliott up on the outside. Ernie Irvin says, no, that's not the smart thing to do. He'll dip down behind Darrell Waltrip.
Waltrip peels off, moved through. He is now going to 30. He had a bad day yesterday in a Grand National, about 21st position on the end of it, looking to turn his season around. Still hasn't had that win this year. He says, we're a lot better than we look. Well, he's looking very good right now in third spot, running 15 car lengths back to Earnhardt at number three and 24. Gordon.
There are those two cars we mentioned. Sterling Marlin in the blue car, Jimmy Henson in the white car, have just gone a lap down.
Coming around to complete 21 laps. In front with 55 miles complete. Stay with us. Back with you once again at Talladega after 22 of 188 laps, and they're skirmishing for the lead right now. The man putting the pressure on, as you look at the top 10, is the two-time winner Waltrip, who's going for the lead coming to the strike. He and Earnhardt side by side. It's Waltrip on the bottom in the 17, the two-time winner. And here at Talladega, the Dega Dominator, the only man to win it four times, Earnhardt high on the outside, going back into the lead off turn two, and with him comes Jeff Gordon. To drop in on Neil Bonnett. Third position is where he's at with a handful. His team, which is the Dale Earnhardt team for Grand National Racing, down there, they had tires ready because he did get pinched up in the wall. Here you see him with Jimmy Spencer down below.
Boy, and we saw Darrell Waltrip up there a moment ago. Don't see him there now. We'll pan back here and see if we can catch him. He is down on the inside. You still don't see him. Darrell Waltrip has dropped far back. There he is, down on the inside. See how far back he has dropped after fighting for the lead there just a moment ago. But had nobody down there with him. And, boy, if you don't have a drafting partner, you're in trouble. Now Kyle Petty pulls up behind him.
And now 10th. Getting a little help from Kyle down at the bottom. The high side is the fast side of town here at Talladega this afternoon, as Earnhardt, Gordon, Elliott, Irvin run 1, 2, 3, 4. On Strickland comes to fifth, Morgan Shepherd at sixth, Wally Dahlenbach having a great ride in the Jack Roush car, number 16, up to seventh, Dale Jarrett's in eighth, Schrader has come from 25th up to ninth, and then back there in 10th is Brett Bodine. Top four. This will be 27 laps when they come to the strike. 71 miles down. No cautions today. A Talladega traffic jam at 190 miles an hour through the 18-degree banking. The 33-degree banking to turn one. Just put it on the floor, Madden. See how long you can stay brave.
That's what it takes here. Here's Morgan Shepherd. You saw him taking a peek up on the high side as we look out the rear window of Dale Earnhardt's car. Jeff Gordon content just to hang right on to Earnhardt there. Here comes Hutch Strickland down on the inside by himself, trying to make a move. Get past here on this front straightaway.
Fades back in. Gave it a shot. Now eases back in line. six. Dahlin back to seven. Waltrip stays on the bottom.
Yeah, he likes to run low, but he just needs some help down there. He really goes through turns one and two down on the inside, but when he gets headed down the backstretch, his momentum is taken away. Those that are running the high groove have more momentum coming off the turn, so they shoot down that straightaway, and it's hard to stay up with them.
Here he is closing in on Brent Bodine. Not for long.
Now here comes Darrell's brother, the yellow car up there, Michael Walker. Maybe he'll have to pull out and help him out there. I bet he won't. I bet he'll just drive by him on the outside. Say, brother, you got yourself in that position. Now he's going to let Darrell in. No, he's not. He's going to come right up on the outside of him. Say, brother, you got yourself in that position. You're going to have to hang with him. But it's tough when your brother won't help you. You can't expect anybody else to help.
Fading back. Waltrip, who gave it a run right for the lead in this lead draft. What have you got up there now? About 25 cars in that lead pack?
There are still, yes, about 30 in the lead pack that are certainly, they have not lost the draft yet. There's a little bit of space after about 15 cars.
With the leaders. And Earnhardt.
So Morgan Shepherd looking at that high side. He continues to look up there. All he needs is just the width of that Ford Thunderbird, and he'll stick it up there.
And 21 car back in fifth spot, just behind the number four. That's Morgan Shepherd. And he is having another good run as we close in on these leaders. There you see Morgan in the 21. He hasn't led a diehard 500 since back in 89. He drove for Raybach. He looks like he wants to get up there and mix it up. And he's having a good time in the points this year with the Wood Brothers, number 21. Morgan Shepherd qualified 23rd for today's race, currently fourth in the Winston Cup points. Lies fifth in the field, Strickland in sixth. You see Dahlin back in seventh. Everyone following the Dega Dominator, Dale Earnhardt. Back with you live at Talladega, Alabama on the 2.6 mile high banks here. Here you see Earnhardt leading after 31 laps, 82 miles complete. Narrow your caution flag to date. Gordon second, Elliott, Urban, Shepherd, Hutch Strickland, Wally Dahlin back, Dale Jarrett, Ken Schrader, Brett Bodine, all in a bundle up there. And 15 others. Around this immense racing facility. Average speed stayed right about 190 miles an hour. Had a very easy start. Neil Bonnet, he's up to 23rd. He had fallen back to 26. He and Robbie Gordon cutting their way through the field. Robbie Gordon currently in 18th. Look at these leaders.
We'll have pit stops coming up in the next five or so laps again.
Let's go to Mike Joy and check on those pit stops.
Ken, the magic number is 47. If this race goes green the entire 188 laps, you would need to stop every 47 laps to make this just a three pit stop race. That's four tanks of fuel. We've not had a caution so far, so here in the Earnhardt pit, that's the number they need to get to. Richard Childress said we need 47. We can go 48, maybe 49. So that's the number.
Well, that's a lot more than they normally go when they don't run restrictor plates. About 100 miles is all they can go when they don't have restrictor plates, as we see Ernie Irvin come down on the inside. But yes, they do get much better fuel mileage with the restrictor plates. So 47 laps, good information. So that's still about 12 laps away.
Ernie Irvin, defending diehard champion. Mixing it up again, coming back in.
And I think we're seeing a lot of cars, they're content now to most of them, at least Ernie Irvin, he continues to drop down there, but most of them are content to run in single file in this first group of cars, and I think they might, maybe some of them need some chassis adjustments, their tires are getting old, maybe the car's getting a little bit loose, and so they're just content to ride there until they make the pit stop and make an adjustment. For these drivers back here, that's not the case. Where Neil Bonnet is, they're racing side by side, passing each other, and getting on with it.
Neil Bonnet fighting back at 24th, falling back again. Here goes Bobby Hillen and Labonte, both squeezing past him. Trying to break it back up to the 20th position from whence he started. Bobby Hillen giving him a real run here. That's Hillen just in front of him. Hillen, in a dramatic moment at Pocono, did a 360 right in front of Waltrip. Why he didn't get collected was a miracle. Lake Speed having a good run. Back there about 24th. 23rd, the 31 car.
Now, folks, even though he is in 23rd position, he is only about the length of a good par five golf hole behind the leader. See there, how close all of them are?
Well, he better get the wood out right now if he wants to catch up with Earnhardt and Gordon. Jeff Gordon, relentless in his efforts to win his first Winston Cup race at age 21. And here you see Kyle Petty and Mark Martin. They've been storming back through the field. Kyle Petty being shown at the present time in 17th position. Martin right with him. And I think that's been a major change. I think that Kyle Petty is torn up through the field. Corey is showing us something different. I believe Kyle is much closer to the front. We can check
well,
him
no,
as
he
come by
he went
this
backwards
time.
Pretty good. He was up there in second place for a while, but he has dropped back quite a bit in the field and has settled in back there.
Well, he's 16th.
Yeah,
they had him in 24th.
Okay. Drafting on Michael Waltrip right now. We see this trio up front there. That's Bill Elliott in third, Jeff Gordon in second, and Dale Earnhardt in first. There they are, lapping the car number 7 and number 8 again. Both of those drivers having problems early here today, just drafting on each other. Here's Morgan Shepherd. He tried it high several times. He's going to try Bill Elliott on the low side, hoping Ernie Irvin would come with him. Ernie didn't. Ernie sees this as an opportunity to get back by Morgan. Let's see if he's going to do it.
Morgan had better tuck in or he's going to drop a couple.
Yeah, he tucked back in there. Said that's not going to work now.
Now he's found a dancing partner. Ernie Irvin comes along. Sashay up through here, will you? Nope. Now there's the 28 car. That's Robbie Gordon. He is being shown in the 19th position right now.
He's sort of sitting there running by himself, Ken. He's about 10 car lengths behind the next place car, which would be Mark Martin. And just sitting there, he has one car about 3 or 4 car lengths behind him, Rick Wilson. But he's just running along there by himself. Good position, really. That's a good experience for him. We see Wilson close in as he go into the turn, picking up the draft.
Give you an idea just how close Mark Martin is to him, or he to Mark Martin. He has said one of the things he really wants to do is bring this car home. He realizes the pressure that's on him here today. So he faded it back out of that heavy draft. Ned was talking earlier in our opening today, if you're just joining us, about Robbie Gordon taking over the Davey Allison ride. And he went out for a final practice period yesterday and did some pretty serious sparring out there. Kyle Petty and some others really rubbed him around a little.
Well, they did. They were giving him some lessons in drafting, not necessarily intentionally, but certainly gave him something to think about overnight. They were passing him on the high side and the low side, and he'd go back in a pack, and they'd all pass him, and then he'd work his way back up, and here they'd go at him again, just like they're doing here right now.
Bobby Labonte on the outside at 22. Mike Joy is ready to check into the Neil Bonnet pits.
Well, Bobby Hutchins is a pretty fine modified driver. He's Richard Childress's computer engineer, and today he's Neil Bonnet's crew chief. How's he doing?
Doing a great job right now. Neil's just trying to get a feel for the car and the traffic, and hopefully we'll be in here at the end.
It looks like Neil can ride in the draft with whatever pace they want to run, but can he get out and pass?
Yeah, he's pretty good. Right now we're a little tight up off the corner. We're going to make a little adjustment on the stop here, and hopefully we pick up a few spots.
Bobby said earlier he'd love to drive one of these things, but I don't think today would be the day.
Pretty warm out there, and I just hope Neil pulls through on this thing for us.
Thanks, Bobby.
Thank you. Snaking their way around this 2.6-mile track.
And Darrell Waltrip has found him some dancing partners down on the inside and has got that low groove and coming back towards the front. Remember a while back he dropped way back in the back? He's back up near the front now, drafting on Ernie Irvin.
Here he comes with Irvin going for third. Bill Elliott there on the outside. Here you see Bobby Labonte. He is now up to 22nd position. Remember, he started as a provisional from 41st. Bobby Labonte at number 22, the rookie, right in there now closing. Looks like he's ready to close up on Dale Jarrett for the moment. Rather on Kyle Petty. Battles continue with 42 of 188 laps at Talladega Super Speedway in Alabama.
This Diehard 500 race summary is sponsored by Ford. Have you driven a Ford lately?
After 119 miles have been completed, only four leaders thus far in this intense competition. Three lead changes, averaging 191 miles an hour. Caution free, no cars have officially retired from the event. Right now, we do have a new leader. Today's overhead shots are courtesy of the Goodyear Blimp Stars and Stripes, based in Pompano Beach, Florida. At the controls, Captain Dick Esch from Sunrise, Florida. Looking down on that new leader, Ernie Irvin. Came up with Waltrip. Now Waltrip has fallen back into fourth. You see Earnhardt in second, Jeff Gordon in that third spot. They should be about a lap away. Robbie Gordon in that 28 car. Remember, he faded to 26 on the start. Well, he's back. He is now in eighth position. Robbie Gordon right there in car number 28. Giving that Robert Yates machine a whale of a ride. He waited out those initial laps, Ned. Now he's storming.
Yes, he is. He learned a lot. Here's Ken Schrader just having made a pit stop. He was running up there in the top 10. And Brett Bodine is in the pits as well. So we'll see lots of cars coming in here very shortly.
Lap 46 is when this is happening. Bobby Hillen has just pitted.
And Richie Petty made a pit stop a couple laps ago. That's the nephew of Richard Petty, son of Maurice. And he got called back in for a stop-and-go penalty for going too fast on pit road. The pit road speed today is 65. Dale Jarrett is in the pits. So is Terry Labonte, several others making pit stops here now on this lap 47.
Looks like they're getting ready to pit up in front.
Yeah, I think we'll see the leaders coming. You can see those signals that they're waving them off. We're about to come in. That's Dale Earnhardt giving a signal. He's going to come in this time around. He wants to run as fast as he can, as long as he can. But he wants them to be aware behind that he's got to slow down and he's coming into the pits.
And so is Irvin. We'll see.
Yeah, there are a lot of the leaders will be coming in this time. There they come down pit road right now. There's Ernie Irvin, Dale Earnhardt, Morgan Shepherd.
Pit road speed, 65 miles per hour today. Leaders are all in. Waltrip is there, the whole gang. Full seal change, first stop under green. Let's go to David Hobbs.
Well, Larry McReynolds and his crew doing the first pit stop ever on a non-Davy Allison car here this afternoon. Robbie Gordon, having driven fantastically well this afternoon, pulling up, letting himself go back in the draft, learning how to do it on this, the super speedway of all times, and pulls himself up to about eighth spot before he stopped. Crew did a tremendous job.
Well, looks like they only changed the right side tires on Earnhardt. Maybe that's all any of them are doing. Ernie Irvin and Ricky Rudd both beat Earnhardt out. Darrell Waltrip is right there. The two Gordons racing side by side down into turn one. They're not related.
Elliott with the lead. And now you see Elliott on pit road, just coming in for his stop with the Junior Johnson car. Looking for that first win of 93.
Extended stay on pit road. They've been moving or changing a spark plug wire on the Kulwicki Racing Thunderbird. I got his fuel. It's been a long time here with the hood up. I believe he's already gone at least one lap down, but they have refired his car. He's going back on the racetrack.
When all of these pit stops are shuffled out, Ernie Irvin is going to be the lead. He and Ricky Rudd made the two best pit stops, and they're out there running by themselves. Right there they are. And they are going to be the leaders. In fact, they indeed now are being posted as the leaders. Earnhardt is third. Jeff Gordon is fourth. Robbie Gordon is fifth. Darrell Waltrip is sixth. Dale Earnhardt is seventh. I mean, Dale Jarrett Earnhardt. And in eighth place is Mark Martin. And sixth came out in ninth place.
Rod, the winner in Michigan. Some very savvy work up there and a great fuel range on that car number five.
And here we're looking at the windshield of Dale Earnhardt. And you see how far he has to go to catch the car number four of Ernie Irvin and the car number five of Ricky Rudd. And they're reeling them in a hurry. He has Jeff Gordon drafting on his rear bumper. And they are coming towards the front in a hurry.
This is happening at lap number 52 of 188. 138 miles have been completed. Window net seems to be loose on Darrell Waltrip's car. Maybe a consultation flag out for Waltrip. Check that story in a moment. The Die Hard 500 from Talladega Super Speedway will continue after this message and a word from your local station. You, Talladega, Alabama, 54 laps down, front pack of cars, Ernie Irvin, Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt, Jeff Gordon, then you fade back about 2 seconds and you find the second pack of cars. Robbie Gordon for the moment is leading that group with Mark Martin, Greg Saxon, Dale Jarrett. They continue to shuffle them around out there. Now that number 8 car is really marked.
Oh, the 28 car is in trouble.
Robbie Gordon getting in the wall hard. Caution out for the first time today. It is directly beneath us. It is about 150 feet to the right of the flag stand. It is right in the same area that Bobby Allison had that horrifying crash here years ago. Got up into that fence, the fence held and all, and Robbie Gordon in the Robert Yates number 28. We'll have to take a look at that one again as he was leading that second group.
Okay, and they were coming up on some lap cars. He got down on the inside, maybe got his left wheels down on the flat a little bit too much there, and the air affecting Ken, and the back end just went around on him. He slides backward there. You see Dale Jarrett going on the outside of him. Then he slams into the wall with the right front of the car, stays up against that outside wall, and comes to rest there.
Lap cars of Stanley Smith and Sterling Marlin were the ones he was trying to go beneath. Of course, he's been at Daytona once, and we saw him at Richmond. That was the level of his experience. I think he had a couple of ARCA races, but it's all come to naught here today. He gave it a good run. He'd fallen all the way back, made a run back up through the field, and was leading the second pack as we came back out of commercial. But 24-year-old Robbie Gordon, who qualified 14th for today, looks like he's out of it.
CBS Sports presents the Die Hard 500, sponsored by Die Hard, the official battery of NASCAR, AT&T, the right choice, and by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car.
At Talladega, Alabama, with Neil Bonnet. In the number 31, the entire field has taken this opportunity to come back on pit road, make adjustments, take on some added rubber. Here you are riding with Neil, his first time back in 3 years. Looking good out there at the present time.
How's it going, Neil?
I tell you what, Ken, this thing has been a ball. What a traffic jam. I tell you, the guys, there's so many cars running the same speed. You got to really be careful working it outside and inside lane. You know, it's just, I'm probably a little rusty on it, but I've been trying to pick it up here.
How are you doing with the heat? How are you doing with the heat, Neil?
Feel great. I tell you what, I got this old cool suit sitting over here. I've been turning it off and on. I'm sure I ain't as comfortable, Ned, sitting up there with that air-conditioned booth, but boy, am I having some fun out here. It's not as bad as I really anticipated it. I can raise this shield, and the air coming from the outside is actually hotter than the stuff I just got in the car. So I'm leaving the shield down. I got the cool suit working. Everything's going good right now.
Looked to us like the only problem you had was trying to find your pit coming down pit road there.
Yeah, let me tell you, we kind of made a different sign, and I'm just not that familiar with it. And you got to remember, it's a long time since I turned down there, and there's 40 boards up, and, you know, 2,000 people want you to come in, and I'm just a little confused on where they are. Probably hurting us some coming down pit road, but I just want to be careful. We don't cause any problems.
Yeah, I saw you right there in front of your old buddy Earnhardt.
Yeah, I just about blocked him in, and I think he ain't gonna like that. We talked about that before the race. I was concerned about blocking him in coming down. We were gonna try to work back and forth, but it just worked out where I kind of pinned him. But looks like that thing of his is good enough to get to the front. I'm just gonna sit here. We talked about it. I've been thinking about diving in the bottom, but I need to get some experience on this outside, working this traffic. We'll run this thing all day long. There's a lot of race car left right here. At the end of the day, we'll see how much we got.
Well, if you're going to chop off your boss, probably pit road's the best place to do it, Neil.
All righty, man.
Here's Mike Joy.
These are the tires that came off of Bill Elliott's car, Ken. Under green, they changed right side tires. And you can see these are barely worn. Those are the wear indicators. Under caution, they just changed the left side tires. And again, very good tire wear. The only reason they changed tires at all is temperature. These tires were measured at 200 degrees across the tread. Cooler tires put on the car will run faster than warmed up ones like these. And you can change two tires in less time than it takes to fuel the car. But the tire wear and temperatures are excellent. They did take a round of bite out of the left rear of Elliott's car when he made this most recent stop, though, to try to improve the handling just a bit.
Bill Elliott, the man who sat on the pole for today's race, looking for that first win of the season. Now the 28 car, and that car, after it had slapped the wall, actually fired, and Robbie Gordon drove it down to the inside, drove it about another 150 feet, and they're looking at it now. It looks like they may try to get this car back in the race. Robbie Gordon having a big problem up here in the trioval area of the track as he tried to move beneath the cars of Sterling Marlin and Stan Smith that were a lap down, and it looked like a rookie error.
Yeah, he made a move to the inside, which is a natural move, but I think he got his wheels down on the left side where it was a little bit flat down there,
the
and then you combine that with the air off of the other cars, taking the off of the rear spoiler of his car, and it just lifted the back end around, and around he went. Yeah, if he had been running here for a year or two, he would have known not to make that kind of a move.
Two cars have elected not to pit. They are Ernie Irvin, the leader, and Ricky Rudd in second. The third place car, as we get set to ramble once again, would be Dale Jarrett, and we're at least a lap away. The light is still on the pace car. Taking a look at Robbie Gordon's car as they continue to work on it there. Here's the top five.
No, that's not right. Dale Jarrett is third, and in fourth place is Greg Saxon. Fifth place is Terry Labonte after they came out of the pits.
That was after 56 laps as they
yep,
were on
right.
the field.
Yep.
And right now we're showing 59 laps complete. 59 are now in the books here this afternoon, and that gets us down to 156 miles complete. Ernie Irvin stays in front, Rudd in second, Jarrett third, Sachs fourth, Terry Labonte fifth, Mark Martin sixth, Gordon is seventh. Rick Wilson will be eighth, Earnhardt back in ninth as we get set on that restart, which is probably, as we say, a lap away. You think they're going to try to bring that Robbie Gordon car back?
Well, I don't know. They'll look at it. The reason they would do it would be, one, to give him more experience, but also to gain car owners' points. Every position they could gain would mean that many more points, and that could be important at the end of the year.
Fearless driver, this Robbie Gordon, eighth in the IndyCar points at the present time. And that car was so strong off turn two yesterday in that last practice period, and it was looking good today. He brought it all the way back through the field.
He was running fifth when he had his misfortune.
Said, I've got a lot to learn. Hopefully we won't make a mistake in this race. But right here in the trioval, awfully easy to do. It looked like he had plenty of room to make the move.
Yep, but getting down on that inside and with that air off those other cars, it just took it away from him. They'll get the signal now. One more lap to go until we'll go back to green.
Now, Ernie Irvin has won three of the last four Super Speedway races here and is the luckiest driver here.
You saw those pictures we showed you a little earlier. If you're just joining us, yesterday, Earnhardt won the preliminary event, the Grand National race, and in the drive in that last lap, Ernie Irvin going down the back straightaway had the back end 8 feet off the ground, floating backwards, and the car just settled down. Around he came, finished the race up. He was making a strong bid to win yesterday and do what he did a year ago when he won on Saturday, then came back and won on Sunday. Earnhardt seems to have that advantage, if it is an advantage, coming into today's race. And there's Rudd right with him, and Rudd seems to be rejuvenated now.
Yeah, he has a strong car. He was strong yesterday in practice. He got shuffled back a little bit earlier in the draft, but he's right there now. 34 cars in the lead lap. Let's go to the pits and Mike Joy.
Gary Dehart is Ricky Rudd's team manager. They won at Michigan on CBS, a combination of track position and gas mileage, and you did not stop on this caution.
Tell you, Mike, everybody's got to make two more stops just regardless, and we're going to go for track position at this time. And I guess Ernie did too, so we'll just see how it unfolds. We're okay on tires. Tires are not really a major problem here, so fuel is. But like I say, everybody's got to go at least two more stops, so we're okay.
Well, now this means you'll have to stop about 5-8 laps before the rest of the cars that came in on this caution, so you've got to be hoping for another caution between now and then.
Yeah, that's true, but we might can go 5 or 8 more.
Well, they did at Michigan, and they ended up in victory lane. We'll see how it plays out.
You notice how he said we might could?
Yeah.
That's a pretty good indication that they can.
Can or cannot.
That they can go another 5 or 8 laps. But Mike was right, Mike Joy, when he pointed out that they will have to stop more than likely some 5 to 8 laps before the others. And if a caution comes out in between there, then that could hurt them.
Average speed now 170.848. That was through lap 60. And that's down from the old record, from the record. Cale Yarborough in 1981 at 192.676.
Not many cars lining up down on the inside because most of the cars are still on the lead lap. About a half a dozen cars down on the inside. The cars that are in the lead lap start up on the outside at the green flag waves, and we're off racing again.
As they come down to complete lap 61, Ernie Irvin brings the field across. Rudd second, Jarrett right there with him.
Rudd got off to a little bit of a slow start. Ernie jumped him about 6 or 7 car lengths there on the start of the race. But now Rudd beginning to close back in as he picks up the draft. You can see just how much that helps. He might even be able to blow by him down the back stretch.
Everybody away and racing once again. CBS live coverage of the Die Hard 500 from the Talladega Super Speedway today. Ernie Irvin in front. Here's David Hobbs with the report.
Right in front of us. Spotter was doing an excellent
job. Hi, I'm with Robert Yates, the car owner. Robert, what exactly happened with Robbie Gordon there?
Well, everything was looking real good. You know, he's got plenty of experience. He worked his way from the back of the field back to the front. The spotter was giving him really good directions. He told him to stay with Mark, and he said, if you're going to pass this slow car, you're going to have to do it on the low side. So they went low. They came up where the apron gets very flattened out. Since he was leading, they got it down on the flat, and when he tried to make that transition back up on the racetrack, it turned it around, and probably not anybody could drive out of that situation. Just going to the racetrack is, I guess we've learned that spot now.
I see you and Larry McReynolds looking under the rear wheel arch. What's happened? Has it broken the axle?
Well, it's bent the rear end housing, pulled the shocks loose, trailing, you know, track bar loose. It's really from the rear back is damaged pretty severely. They're going to go ahead and work on some things. And if they can get the alignment good on it, well, we can go back and run good. We'll go back out. If we can't, our team will be going home. And thanks to, you know, all the fans here in Alabama and all the race fans around the country and the world for supporting us. This has been an awful tough trip. The way we were running shows what kind of race team we have, and certainly for Robbie, did a super job of coming in and jumping in something totally unknown, at least for the last couple of years, and for our race team to think in there and give him a good call. We had a good shot at running off good, and you know, the high banks, he was down there on the low banks, and when he came up, it just happened right in front of us. We did all the things we could do. It just, you can't stay there. When you start going through that part of it, you got to move back up.
Well, we want to thank you very much for a tough end to a tough week, and I guess you guys are going to get out on the track again. Yeah.
Robert Yates made the toughest speech he's ever made in racing.
about 12 days ago when he said, whenever we go to a track, we always go with the expectation of winning. This time, we don't feel we can win. And that was the one time that car number 28 has not appeared since the 8th race he came to. Tough day for him. But they're back here this week, and they had a good accounting by Robbie Gordon until he made that error up here in the tri-oval area. We'll wear that one for a long time.
Yes, he will, but I'm sure he really learned from it. And the field beginning to tighten up now. Six cars had pulled away, but now they have tightened up with Jeff Gordon leading Rick Wilson and Dale Earnhardt and Kyle Petty. They've caught up to the lead pack. Ernie Irvin still the leader.
65 laps complete. So Irvin stays first. Rudd is in second. Dale Jarrett looking them over. Gosh, Ned, you may get another workout here at the finish the way the kid's running right now.
We'll see.
Shuffling the deck again here at Talladega, Alabama. And for the moment, Dale Jarrett has just taken over. It's Dale in front. Jeff Gordon has taken second. Earnhardt falling to third. And back to fourth goes Ernie Irvin. Irvin had led just a lap ago. In fifth spot is Greg Sachs. Here comes 21-year-old Jeff Gordon on the inside of the Daytona 500 champion.
Watch Earnhardt, see if he tries to make it three abreast down the backstretch. No, he stays up behind Jarrett. Pushes him on out there. Here comes Irvin back again.
Coming about to complete 69 laps, Darrell Waltrip may have lost the cylinder, and he has gone into the pit area. Waltrip back. Take a look again at what happened just moments ago here. Bring out the first caution of the day to Robbie Gordon as he came through the tri-oval.
And he was down on the inside attempting to pass some lap cars, got his left wheels down on the flat part of the racetrack. That and the combination of the air just took the air off the back end, spun him around out of the race, and he is with David Hobbs in the garage area.
Well, Robbie Gordon, they've just seen it all again. Maybe you could just talk us from your point of view.
Well, what I felt from inside the car, you know, I felt I got out of the pits. I was running fourth. Jeff got by me. I lost the lead draft. Finally, I got hooked up with Mark, and I think we were catching Sterling. I don't know if he was on the lead lap or not, or a blue car, all I can say. And we had a good run coming out of four down into the tri-oval, and there was another car up high, so I figured we're better off going down low. And as soon as I started going down low, it felt like that car was, you know, was running me down into the apron a little bit. And I think maybe I touched the apron or lost the air, one of the two. But, you know, hopefully it didn't wear out our welcome here because we were having a great time in the Texaco car.
Hey, I've got to go, Robbie. There's been another accident on the track. Thank you.
All right.
Racing back to the line. Sterling Marlin trying to make up a lap. There's Stan Smith's car demolished, and there's some flame coming out of the Alabama driver's car. Take a look at what happened here that's brought out the second caution of the day.
There's Stanley Smith in the middle in the black car. They were running three abreast going into that turn, Ken. There's the car number one of Rick Mast.
There is one car that has gone over the wall, as you see in that. And we'll get that for you in a moment. Stan Smith's car was destroyed. There is another car that went off the top of the... Here you see Smith being administered to. It was a five-car wreck. It happened in lap 69 in turn one. Smith's car has been brought to a halt along with three others, and we'll take a look again, and we'll look at it in slow motion now.
Okay, they're entering turn number one, Ken. And it looks like somebody got into the wall and then came back down into the other cars. And then there is a car going over the wall. It's a red car. It could be the car number 32 of Jimmy Horton. We think that's who it is, but we're not absolutely sure. And there's Rick Mast coming in there. The car number 37 of Loy Allen was involved in it.
Richie Petty's car was collected as well.
We're still not totally sure which car that was that went over the wall. It was a red car, and we're speculating only that it could have been the car number 32 of Jimmy Horton, but we'll get the official word and pass it along to you just as quickly as we can.
Loy Allen's car was involved. The Richie Petty car was involved.
And there are the remains of the car that went over the wall.
And it looks like someone standing there with a helmet, Ken.
And got out of that.
Let's hope that is the case. The helmet goes off. And boy, if that's the case, that is very, very good news.
I believe that is Horton for sure. See, there's the bank that it came down. Jimmy Horton, the active trucking Chevrolet, who had started 24th today, taking this nasty ride out of the track. I can't remember the last time we saw a car out of a speedway, Ned.
No, I can't either. It's been a long, long time. It dates back to the day. Yeah, you can see the number 32 on the side of that car now. And it did land on its wheels. At first, it looked like it was upside down, but the top and the deck lid just in the hood and all of that have just simply been ripped away from the car.
So I believe it's the first time a car has ever gone over the wall at Talladega.
And there you see what those cars getting together, and he was right being pushed by another car right up into the wall, and it just tumbled right up. There's the Rick Mass car number one. The car number 37 spinning, that's Loy Allen Jr. And the car number 53 of Richie Petty is involved. And of course, Stanley Smith, Kenny Wallace was involved in it. And of course, Jimmy Horton, whose car went over the wall.
Bridgewater, New Jersey native, Jimmy Horton. There's what's left of car number 32 after it rolled on the speedway, then got over the wall. And that wall is what, 4.5 or 5 feet? What a tribute to the roll cages in these cars. An unbelievable incident in turn number one. This guy's had some super speedway experience too. He's won some ARCA races at Daytona, won the Poland 500 here at Talladega back in 91. But well, he sure ran out of luck here today. The good news is he seems to be okay. We'll update you with more on this story in a moment.
This Die Hard 500 race summary is sponsored by Goodyear, number one in tires.
After 197 miles have been completed in this 500-mile event, 7 lead changes, or rather 10 lead changes among 7 drivers, and the average speed down to 169 miles per hour. 2 caution periods, we're still under the second. Just knocked off the 7th lap under this caution period. They continue to work on Stan Smith. He is out of the car, he is on the ground, and Stan Smith, Alabama driver, has been injured. Car number 49, you see the rescue squad there working with Stan Smith. Very likable driver who came out of that racing series down here in the South. Won a championship, I believe they call it the American Racing Series, something like that. And he
used to be the Grand American Series. NASCAR, now the Winston All-Pro Series.
Here's Mike Joy.
I'm in Jimmy Horton's pit, Steve Lesniewski. It's Steve Doozy. I know that from a long time. His dad used to own Modifieds. You guys were as stunned as everybody else when that car went over the wall. Did Jimmy say anything on the radio or give you any indication what happened before he got out?
Now, we couldn't get hold of Jimmy on the radio. Either he's out of range out there in the parking lot or something. Too bad, because running good, biding his time. And, you know, these guys get to running 2-3 wide for no reason. They come down off the wall, took him out. So, tough day for the active Chevy.
Okay, Jimmy Horton, though, we saw walk out of the car, and well, they just moved the monitor. They saw it the same way we did on the TV monitor here with that view from above. But Jimmy, the report is he is okay.
All right, we're waiting for a further update on Stan Smith, who was making his first start in 1993. Only other race was at Daytona, as they get the ambulance out here now. Was in a 125-mile qualifier at Daytona, and his car was hit by a Steve Kinzer's car down there, and he did not qualify. Looked serious. It looked far more serious for Horton, but it looks like Stan Smith has received some injuries in this crash. Remember that, you know, whenever you think about an over-the-wall crash, you think back to that
incident at the Daytona Speedway in 61 when Lee Petty and Johnny Beauchamp got
exactly.
Over the wall.
Okay, we'll take a look at it again. As the cars got in trouble, got together going into turn one, there's Stan Smith in that black car and the yellow car, and the car 32 of Jimmy Horton, the red car, getting caught up in that, pushed up into the wall and over the wall. There's the car number 37 of Loy Allen spinning down on the inside. He has made several pit stops. He's still in the race.
But it's the Smith car that stayed up on the wall and took all that impact head on into the wall and then stayed up there for so long. And of course, he had no control at that time. Everything was gone in the front end. Under caution at lap 74, the Diehard 500 from Talladega Superspeedway continues after this message and a word from your local station. We're back with you live at Talladega Superspeedway in Alabama. A major incident in turn number one of this racetrack back about lap number 69. Stan Smith has been injured. A total of five cars were involved in the incident. Stan Smith, Alabama racer, being taken to the infield care center here at the track. The car of Richie Petty, the nephew of Richard Petty, was involved in the incident. Loy Allen's car, Rick Mast, and the Horton car left the track. It went out of the facility down onto a auxiliary road just off the first turn area. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Well, they're packing up Stanley Smith's pit here. They tried to reach him by radio after that incident down in turn one and were unable to. They did get a report that the rescue crews had to remove the right side window that's flush down the right side of the car and go in from the right side to help Stanley out of the race car. They put him on a backboard into an ambulance and have taken him to the infield care center. But they were not able to talk to him by radio to find out what happened in the crash.
The caution car is in front of the field, bringing him through the tri-oval at this time.
And Ken, the last time we saw that the cars following the caution car, Kyle Petty was in the lead, but he has made a pit stop. Now they've run 47 more laps. Here we go again with this replay of the incident down in turn.
Now watch the black car getting hit there.
And Horton's car immediately turns over.
Yep.
And rolls right on up over the wall.
And then the Smith car is that black car with a yellow number that went in underneath the Horton car, drove it into the wall, then it stays up in the wall as you see the Rick Mast car, the number one car in trouble, Richie Petty's car in trouble.
That's Richie Petty, the white car, with the red numerals. And you see the Stanley Smith car, the black number 49, staying up against the wall, then comes down to the inside of the racetrack. It almost looks as if he's steering that car down through there, Ken, but you know, it was out of control.
While we're waiting for more information, David Hobbs is on his way to the infield care center here at the Talladega Superspeedway. Smith began his Winston Cup career right here on this track. We saw him 3 years ago out here, qualified 12th for his first race. A lot of people thought that he could be another upset winner, as we had in so many of those first events in this 500. We'll be back with more from Talladega in a moment. We're getting ready to resume here. Let's take a look at the standings. Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, Bill Elliott, Shepard, Jarrett, the front five. We understand they are going to move Stan Smith to the Caraway Medical Center by helicopter at this time, and there are the medical people. Rescue team taking him to the chopper after this incident at the Talladega Superspeedway today, a five-car crash. And this Alabama racing veteran of a lot of dirt tracks in this part of the country making his first race of 1993, injured. We have no further note at the present time as to how serious the injuries are, but apparently they have to be quite serious to be taken into Caraway in this manner. Horton went out of the track, rolled over several times, appears to be okay. We're going to update you on that story just as soon as we have more. 77 laps are complete. We're going back to green. As we do, Martin leads, Gordon second, Elliott third, Shepard fourth, Jarrett fifth, Terry Labonte sixth, Sack seventh, Wallace, Rudd, Brent Bodine, the top 10. Schrader is back in 11th. Earnhardt is in 16th. Neil Bonnet in 18th as they turn him loose.
29 cars still being shown in the lead lap.
Bernie Irvin has led 32 laps today. Earnhardt has led 30 thus far on the afternoon. Back under green, lap 78.
This is the first time that Martin Hartman has led. So he has the 5 bonus points for leading a lap. That is the case in NASCAR Winston Cup racing. Anytime you lead a lap, whether it's under green or caution, you get 5 bonus points. Only one time then the driver who leads the most laps gets 5 bonus points.
Mark Martin, who we saw at Michigan, almost win it. For another gallon or two of fuel, he would have been home. And Ricky Rudd came home victorious that day.
There's Bill Elliott. Haven't seen him in a while up towards the front. He's sitting there in third position.
And Jeff Gordon leans right on that outside retainer. Into the back straightaway. Here you have Mark Martin in first, Jeff Gordon in second, Elliott lies third.
Morgan Shepherd in fourth. Dale Jarrett, Terry Labonte, Greg Sachs, Rusty Wallace, Ricky Rudd, and Brett Bodine.
Just behind them come Schrader, Wilson, Hutt Strickland, Hillen in that group. Leaders coming back. It's Ford, Chevy, and a couple of Fords in the front four. Sachs is having an excellent day. Stan Smith being airlifted to the Caraway Medical Center here. Mark Martin's car stays in front as we watch the ambulance, medical ambulance, the air vac leaving here. Back straightaway, we're watching Horton's car, number 32, being brought in, and there is nothing left of that car that went over the wall. It's gone. Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, Elliott stay up in front. Here's the draft for the lead, and there are 16 cars up in that lead draft as they come by.
Morgan Shepherd had pulled out trying to pass Bill Elliott the last lap, and it cost him several positions. He was in fourth. He now finds himself back in sixth position. There you see him right on the back bumper of Terry Labonte. Labonte running in the fifth position. So you got a Ford out front, a Chevrolet, then another Ford, then another Chevrolet, then another Chevrolet, then another Ford. There's the clear two car of Jimmy Horton. Boy, there.
And that's the good side.
Yeah, that is the good side of the car. Wow.
That reminds you so much of that awful incident that Phil Parsons had in the same first turn. But he didn't go out of the park. He rolled all the way to the top, then rolled all the way back to the bottom of that 33-degree banking back in 83. Here's Mike Joy.
Ken, you mentioned Kyle Petty was leading under caution, then made a pit stop. He thought he might have run over some debris down at turn number one from that accident, so got fresh tires before the restart. Joe Nemechek's the defending NASCAR Grand National champ. He, Steve Grissom, and Randy LaJoy were asked to stay over today in case anybody needed relief from the heat. With what you've seen, you sure you want to get out there in the middle of that?
It looks like fun. You know, we had a great race yesterday, and they're doing it again today.
Pack racing like this, it's a lot of fun, but it can be a little dangerous.
Yes, it can. You know, there's been some accidents today, but everything is so close. The racing is so tight, and you got to have it, and you got to really use your head. It's like a chess game. You just got to play it, and if it comes to you, it comes to you.
He started one Winston Cup race up in New Hampshire. He wants to do some more.
Well, Mike, right now, the leader of the pack is Mark Martin, but there's some real shuffling going on out there. Rusty Wallace, who was down and out of it over the first 30 laps of this event, back in it, although for the moment he's down on the bottom of the racetrack in his own group. Now he's fading back into a position and trying to hold on, but he'd run up there with the front. He just faded back about 8 cars with Earnhardt.
Ricky Rudd and Earnhardt now move down to the inside. You see Earnhardt down there trying to pick up the draft off Ricky Rudd. Rudd on the inside of Morgan Shepherd as they go down the backstretch. Earnhardt, which one's he going to follow? He'll probably follow Shepherd. We'll see. No, he can't. There are 8 cars up there in his way.
And remember that 8 car, Ned, is laps down. Although he's in the lead draft, Sterling Marlin is laps down to those leaders.
Now look at Earnhardt. He found that hole. He just slid himself right up there and left Rudd down there by himself. Challenge for the lead as Gordon goes for it.
Could be 3 wide.
Here they come to the start-finish line. Jeff Gordon will lead that lap.
Jeff Gordon puts it out in front, and Dale Jarrett stays right with him on the bottom of the racetrack. Dale fades it up a couple of grooves.
Both of them slid up to that high groove. They knew that was the place they needed to be. Terry Labonte followed them through, but just couldn't quite make the pass on Mark Martin.
What a good run for Terry Labonte again today. Remember, he finished third yesterday in the Grand National race. And the Corpus Christi veteran who will lead that Billy Hagan team at the end of this year, looking really stout as he goes up into third. Look at the rest of this jam session. Boy, you talk about a pack.
And Ken, that was a 12th lead change in this race. One more, and there will have been 1,000 lead changes at the Talladega Super Speedway.
Just this race.
Not in the Die Hard 500.
To the inside, Ricky Rudd going for fifth spot again. That is a struggle. Elliott right there.
Jarrett going for the lead, hoping Terry Labonte will come with him. He decides that's not the time to do it, so he jumps back in behind Jeff Gordon. Gordon has knocked the fast race car. Here's Earnhardt coming down on the inside. He's got a run. And Jarrett going down. He saw Earnhardt go down, so he decided, well, let me try to go down. But Earnhardt's going to follow Jeff Gordon, leave Jarrett down on the inside. Here they come back to the line.
These pictures coming to you live from Talladega Super Speedway as Earnhardt fights his way back up through, cuts and parries. Here he comes on the outside, going to second. Jeff Gordon in front. The apprentice for the moment leads the master. Some apprentice. This kid is so good. Gordon at number 24 leading Earnhardt. I'm going to write a lot of stories about the two. Ham, what was that motion he just gave over the guy behind there that you saw Earnhardt make, Ned?
Yeah, I think he was motioning to Morgan Shepherd to follow him. He's going to make a pass here. That's exactly what he's trying to do. And Shepherd does, obliges, comes right with him, and here he goes.
Earnhardt for the lead. Morgan Shepherd tucks in. It took just 8 laps for Earnhardt to come from 16th to first.
Three abreast as they go out and turn. Terry Labonte in the middle of that pack. He don't like that. He'll try to get out of there as quickly as he can.
Labonte back to 10th.
Ricky Rudd trying to move on the inside of Dale Jarrett.
Backside of the racetrack. Here comes Ricky Rudd on the bottom.
He has his teammate, another Hendrick Motorsports car, Ken Schrader, following him there on the inside, car number 25.
Earnhardt in front now trying to repulse Jeff Gordon, who's right there trying to take that lead back. Dale Jarrett stays third. Ricky Rudd fourth. Morgan Shepherd in fifth.
The exact position in the late stages of the Daytona 500. It was Earnhardt leading, Gordon in second, and Jarrett in third. Well, look how close Gordon pulls up on the back bumper of Earnhardt as they go into turn one.
And look how those cars just bob and weave out there at 190 miles per hour. It looks so stable here. When you see those pictures from inside, you know they're riding a 200 mile an hour tightrope. Jarrett third, Shepherd fourth.
Battle for fifth, side by side.
Rudd and Martin.
Ernie Irvin right behind Martin.
Hey, Ned.
Ken Schrader behind Ricky Rudd. Yes.
First to 28th. 2 2/10 seconds.
Wow, that's close. Ooh, look how close those cars are, too, coming off the turn. Ricky Rudd side by side yet with Mark Martin.
Mike Joy.
Ray Evernham is Jeff Gordon's crew chief, a former modified racer. He coaches Gordon through each race. We know Jeff likes to run up front. When Earnhardt went by him, what advice did you give him?
Well, actually, he gave me some advice. He said, look, we led a lap and got some points, and we're just going to ride and save this thing for the end. We got a strong car. There's a couple stronger ones. We're just going to have to keep working.
We saw him down on the inside as we see these six cars trying to pull away, but they're only about the last of those six cars. There's Petty again down on the inside. The last of those six cars was Ernie Irvin, and he's not far in front of that seventh place car. In fact, it's catching up to him right now as we speak. Now Kyle sort of run out of running room down there.
Sterling Marlin continues to stay up with these leaders. He's had so many good runs here, but has never won a race. Second again last year. And he lost a lap early today under green flag conditions. Then he had an extended stay on pit road. The crew had to go under the hood, so he's at least three, maybe four laps down. Sterling Marlin at the present time. Not much good luck for him at all this afternoon here at Talladega on the Super Speedway.
Here's Ernie Irvin down on the inside of Morgan Shepherd. They're running side by side. You can see it opened up a little bit of distance with those three cars out in front there. And here's a car slowing down. Looks like it might be Derek Cook. Couldn't see the car slowing down as they came.
Say the rear end.
Okay, it could be the car number 27.
That's 98. That is. You're absolutely right. Cale Yarborough's car. Bob Johnson, the crew chief for Derek Cope. They had a good weekend going, but things have gone awry for them.
Yep, you can see some smoke from underneath that car, Ken, so that doesn't look good for it. It heads into the garage area.
Another retiree from the event. That marked the seventh car out of the race.
He was running 14th.
Here's a report from David Hobbs.
Well, unconfirmed reports from the medical center here say that Stanley Smith is critical, and he's got some head injuries, but they can't determine them here at the speedway. So they've taken him away in the helicopter to the Carraway Medical Center, where they'll do further tests. So unconfirmed that Stan Smith is in critical condition, but we just don't know how critical.
92 laps are complete here today. Stan Smith, not the car that went over the wall, his car head on into it and then slid along for several hundred feet before it came to rest on the bottom of the track. Stan Smith making his first Winston Cup ride here at Talladega today. Coming around to complete 93 laps. Still up first and second, and here you see that battle for third. Morgan Shepherd there with Dale Jarrett coming right along.
He just went around Dale Jarrett on the high side, coming off of turn two. Made a good pass, Morgan Shepherd did. And here's Ernie Irvin down on the inside once again, trying to make some ground, but he couldn't do it. Now he tucks back up in line. Don't want to stay down there too long unless you get somebody to come with you to draft.
Irvin stays seventh, right behind him, and eighth is Ricky Rudd, and then Bobby Labonte. The 22 car stays ninth. The leader, Earnhardt. What a remarkable year he's having as he goes up for that sixth championship.
Look at Ernie Irvin coming once again. He just can't stand it. He's got to get down on that inside. He gets him a run, and he gets up beside some cars. It'll be the halfway mark when they come back.
From Earnhardt's view, what he would see in the rear view mirror. The assault continues. You see Dale Jarrett taking a shot to the inside. A lot of racing left. Stay with us here at Talladega Super Speedway. We just completed 96 laps. At 94, as caution is coming back on the speedway, that would indicate that we have traveled half the distance. We have debris on the track, 250 miles down and 250 to go. Here's how the field was looking. Ernie Irvin was then in correction at that point. Earnhardt Gordon up front looking further back here through the field. Bill Elliott was just outside the top 10. Michael Waltrip, Brett Bodine, Terry Labonte, Hut Strickland back in 15th. And going further back in the field, Rick Wilson hanging on that 20th spot. Richard Petty car, and further back, Bobby Hillen. Lake Speed in there, Dick Trickle, Neil Bonnet in 24. Let's go to David Hobbs right now. We have an update on that incident down in turn number one.
Jimmy Horton, first of all, are you physically okay?
Yeah, we're okay. We just bruised up a little bit. I just want to say hi, Ryan and Jimmy. Daddy's okay.
Can you remember what happened on the wreck?
Well, we just remember going down in the corner, and I saw the 40 car going up against the wall. Wow, we're asphalt racing and all of a sudden we're dirt racing.
Did you know you've gone out the track?
Yeah, when the dirt's flying around, you're not supposed to be doing that. I knew we were in trouble.
Have you seen your car?
Yeah, we got out of it, and you know, I kind of had a chance to look at it a little bit. And I guess it goes to the museum.
That must be one of the scariest incidents you've ever had, right?
Well, anytime you're upside down, whether it's a dirt car or anything, it's scary. But at this speed, it's real scary. But you know, we walked away from it, and we'll be back next week and hopefully racing again.
Okay, thank you.
Under caution for debris on the track. Horton is okay after that serious incident for him as he left the racetrack, the first car ever out of this Talladega Super Speedway, rolling over several times on the asphalt and several times down the embankment, landing on an auxiliary dirt road around the track. Nothing left of the car. He's okay. Stan Smith, the latest report is that he is in critical condition with head injuries. He's been taken to Carraway Medical Center on an air ambulance, and as soon as we have any update at all, we'll pass it along to you. Under caution, field is now coming in. Earnhardt, Gordon, Shepherd, Martin, you see them all in here, taking this opportunity at lap 97, just past halfway, to refuel and take on tires.
So they can make it on one more pit stop from here on, Ken. So they, yes, we'll take that opportunity now to make that pit stop in case it should go green the rest of the way. Here, several cars coming back out already. Earnhardt is apparently changing two tires, and he comes back out in front of Mark Martin there.
Changes among eight drivers really doesn't tell the story of this race at all. This has been very competitive all day, and it's been edge work from the moment it started. This incident down here in turn number one, it was you saw what happened. You said, no, there's no possible way that a car could leave the race. It must be sheet metal. It must be the hood. It must be a piece of it. No, indeed. Entire race car, 3,700 pounds, leaping and lurching up over that concrete wall and bounding down that dirt embankment. And Horton is okay. That's the remarkable part. But the serious injury to Stan Smith reminds you a bit of when, remember when Larry Smith had his tragic crash here in this corner. Went right into that same wall in about the same manner. Let's hope that things are going to be well for Stan Smith, who is really a nice guy.
Certainly our prayers and best wishes will be with him. And as Ken said earlier, we'll pass along any information as soon as we get it.
Continuing a tradition that began in 1960 at the Orange Bowl, today's overhead shots are from the Goodyear blimp Stars and Stripes out at Pompano Beach, Florida. Sure gave good pictures there and good service to let us know what was going on with the Horton car.
I think if we had not had the blimp, I don't think we'd have been able to get a picture of that because it was
long
totally
gone.
It was out of the range of our regular camera.
Young Tennessee driver, great dirt track star Jeff Purvis has just come back on the track. Let's see if we can find Neil Bonnet out here and see how he's doing. Neil, Ken Squire at CBS Control. Can you read us?
Yeah, Ken, I hear you really good.
How's it going?
Pretty hot out here, but I'm feeling pretty decent right now.
Well, you're running in 24th spot. How hot is it out there, fella?
I'll tell you what, it's cooking inside this thing.
How hot?
I've been using a cool suit about 5 minutes and turn it off and then turn it back on. Try not to get used to the thing, but feel a lot better than I thought it would. I thought I'd be wilted by now, but I feel pretty good.
I tell you, Neil, it's remarkable. You've been able to stay right up there in the lead draft of the whole race, so you must feel pretty comfortable with the car.
The car just feels so good, and Richard Childress called me while ago, and that's our game plan, just to stay in this lead lap. You know, I got into the wall early in the race there. Car moved over, didn't see me out there, and I got into the wall on the right side. I didn't know how much damage we had, but it looks like it's okay. And our thought right now is just to stay in this lead lap, and at the end, we'll see what we can do. I'm rusty. I'm not getting in the right places.
Now, Neil, is this sparking something? You said this was going to be a one-race deal. You had no thoughts of coming back and renewing your career totally. How do you feel about that right now?
Well, Ned, it's certainly a lot of fun right here. Let me grab another gear right here. I feel like I've been doing this thing so long, and I had the doctors with the guys that told me I had to quit before, and I really honestly feel like after I run this race, I can step out of this car and say, hey, if I want to quit, I can quit on my own. So, you know, I'm having a lot of fun out here right now, but I just got to sit down after this thing over and reevaluate what's going on. I don't think I'm a threat to hurt these guys anymore. I've been out for 3 years. I got a lot of race car under me right now. We haven't used it all yet. I'll just have to see how this thing plays out.
All right, good luck.
Thank you.
Neil, just don't start selling Jared on it. We need one of you up here.
Don't worry about that.
Number 31, Neil Bonnet, 1980 winner of this event. Never forget those pictures of him and his little girl, Kristen. She's a big girl now.
Oh, yes, she is.
Runs part of the business for Neil. That was a great moment in his career. All right, we're settling down. I think we're going to get one more lap, and they'll turn them loose. They're going to take the light off on the pace car, indicative of a start this time by, and we'll be ready to go racing with Shepherd now leading. Jeff Gordon in second. Dale Earnhardt will be third, followed by Martin.
Then Dale Jarrett in six will be Brett Bodine. What a great run he had at Pocono a week ago, only to come up a little short at the end. Ken Schrader in seventh, Ernie Irvin in eighth, Ricky Rudd in ninth, Bobby Labonte in 10th, Jeff Bodine in 11th as we get set on this restart. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Well, Ken, it's no cooler. It's 100 in the shade here on pit road. They've allowed tent-type canopies for the first time here at Talladega. Most all the teams took on right-side tires and a full tank of fuel. They can go the distance from now on one more pit stop. Bobby Labonte was one of the teams that gambled a bit. They came in for fuel only, hoping to improve their track position over the teams that came in and took on tires and fuel.
Mike, we continue to talk about this heat story here today, and always at Talladega. The cars just don't dissipate heat like they did in the old days, do they?
Well, no, they don't, Ken, but the drivers, as David pointed out at the top of the show, are better protected from the heat. In the winter, you're from Vermont, I'm from Connecticut. We wear hats in the winter because you lose so much heat that evaporates out, comes out through your skull. The same thing's true of cold. I'm so hot I can't even get this story out. They wear a cool hat under their helmet that circulates a fluid, and they have an air blowing cool air into them. So that's keeping them cool. If your head's cool, the rest of your body is cool as well. And so it's a far, far better deal out there now than it would have been 5 or even 3 years ago, before they had such technology to keep the drivers cool. There's a lot of Gatorade, cold water, ice packs down here in the pits, and fortunately, shade.
More than we can say for a lot of these folks out here who have been here since 9 o'clock this morning, the most loyal fans in sport, and there they are, ready to cheer their favorites on at Talladega Super Speedway, coming down for another flag with Morgan Shepherd in first. He has 4 Winston Cup victories. He's never won here. Of course, his car owner, Bud Moore, did, with a great run by Buddy Baker years ago. Jeff Gordon, that youngster who just gets seemingly better in every race, and you're going to hear so much about riding in second, and then the master. Earnhardt working on another victory today, 5 this season, lies third as they come to the stripe. You either love him or hate him, but you have to respect him.
No doubt.
He's one super racer.
He really is. Not many cars down on the inside again, because there are not many cars that are a lap down that are still in the race.
Dale Jarrett holds right on in the fourth spot, and the front four, front two breakaway, and then we have a little pack of four. That four will easily collect the top two, and we'll have a half dozen, with then the possibility of a little more breakaway as they try to snap the whip. Later in this race, you'll see them use that backstretch, try to break off some of those cars. They don't want to decide it among several. They'd like to decide it just by their lonesome, but two is enough, thank you, across this finish line. Rusty Wallace can tell you about that from this past May.
Ken, that blue car right in front of Earnhardt is Sterling Marlin, who is at least a couple of laps down.
Four they're showing.
He has a fast car, but he lost some time earlier in the race. Of course, he's going to move down now, out of the way. He might be moving down to pass Morgan Shepherd.
Yeah, he's going to
lead the race.
Take one of those laps back right now. Second a year ago, second 9 times in his career, but he's never won. Looking good for the moment. Now Morgan with that draft is right there. Jeff Gordon helping him in the back straightaway.
Yeah.
To put Sterling back down the line.
Yeah, he got down there by himself, made a good run off of turn 2 to pull up there beside of Shepherd, but now the lead pack will go by in the high group. He has no one to draft with down there.
Field coming back by.
Can't this concentrate time. On Edie. He got to concentrate on these cars. And here's Gordon going to the high side. That's an unusual pass coming out through there. Moves right around Morgan Shepherd, and going to leave Shepherd down on the inside.
Riding with Earnhardt as he flies up through into second spot. All at over 190 miles per hour here on CBS today. Jeff Gordon looking for that first Winston Cup win in his rookie season. Earnhardt right there with it.
And look how far Shepherd is going to go back as a result of having no one to draft with. Gordon just made that move up on the high side, moved right around him, and left Shepherd down in the bottom group with nobody to draft with. We don't even see it. There he is. Finally comes into the picture, back to that, what, 10th or 12th position before he can finally get back in line.
Just about back in Birmingham. Standings here. Jeff Gordon big advantage, but look how close between Kenny Wallace and Bobby Labonte. And for the moment, Bobby Labonte today is having a super day. PJ Jones is going to get a little help from an old hand.
Yep.
Going to understand that Harry Hyde's going to be there.
He's taking over as the general manager of the Harry Melling race team, and I think that'll be a great asset.
69 years old, yep. Harry.
Still has a lot of knowledge and a lot of spunk left in him. He wants to help build that back to the winning form it was when the Elliots were there. Here's Ricky Rudd trying to move around the Ricky. Bobby Labonte, Rudd in the orange car, number five.
And that blue Labonte, car?
Blue car.
Bobby Labonte in the 22. Maxwell Carr to stay right there. Run, but the man leading is the rookie. What did he have? 500 wins. He's won on everything. Dirt, go-karts, midget, sprint cars, Silver Crown Series, and USAC. Here he is in stock cars. He seems to have really found a home. Robbie Gordon, I wonder, you know, he's doing so well in Indy cars, but he sort of has the look and the feel of a stock car driver, and he gets along with people.
He's a versatile race driver, and I think he can adjust to just about any type of racing as Jeff has done. But here comes Earnhardt, the master, moving down on the inside, taking the lead.
Could have a couple of Gordons out here. We'll have to see. I don't think AJ wants to give up on Robbie Gordon in IndyCar racing. He could be a factor if they wanted to keep him in this series. Back they come to the stripe, and Earnhardt is there another time, looking out the back window. Jeff Gordon right there with him.
Ernie Irvin has moved down on the inside and has Ricky Rudd right on his bumper. Look for Dale Jarrett to pull out and come down and help them again, as they were about to do before the caution came out the last time. Irvin doing going into this next turn. We'll see.
Irvin coming up for fifth. Now this is right where he got airborne yesterday. He got the back end of the car 8 feet in the air at that Grand National. That was just a remarkable picture, and somehow thing, because you never see a car get that high and not start doing those awful sidewinder rolls. It just came back down and continued on as well.
There's a way to keep cool. It's nice.
No 103 degree temperature is going to bother that soul.
Well, I was wrong. Jared didn't make that move down on the inside there.
Here's David Hobbs.
Well, I got one of the all-time greats to meet, Darrell Waltrip. What happened? You were going so well.
That gun thing burned a piston today. It was running just incredibly well. And I tell you, if I'd have ever got by that first car, that last, whoever it was, 4-3 or whoever it would have been, I'd have left him, guys. My car was awesome. We had her right on the edge, and she burned a piston. But the Western Auto Chevrolet was ready for him today, loaded for bear.
How was the heat?
Well, you know, if you got in front or got down there by yourself, it wasn't too bad. But where it was really intense is when you're behind somebody or in groups of cars all around you. And it was really a lot of intense heat coming back from the car in front of you. The hoses, you know, that we run in the side of the car to get air in there, you take 100-degree air and you speed it up through the side of the car at 200 mile an hour, what do you got? You got a blowtorch. And that's kind of what the air coming in the side of the car felt like, was a big blowtorch. But the guys did a fantastic job getting me ready for this weekend. And, you know, I hope people realize that I haven't run bad here because it was my fault. We just haven't had a good car today. We had an awesome car.
Now, there's life in the old dog yet, right?
I can whip most of these guys laying on the ropes.
But not today.
It's nice that he still has that sense of humor with the car sitting in the garage area, but he was strong, no doubt about it. He came right to the front.
Talk about strong. Take a look at Ernie Irvin from fourth to third, now challenging for second, Ned.
He has had the guts to move her down on the inside, whether anybody went with him or not. And by golly, he's got a car strong enough to make the move and to stay down there. Now Dale Jarrett looks like he's going to go with him. He likes what Ernie's doing down there, so he's going to try to help himself.
And Rudd's willing to give a little assistance here.
Yep, those three Chevrolets teaming up against those two Chevrolets up front, and Rudd is going to help push him right on up there. Ernie's right on the inside of Earnhardt now as they go into turn three.
If two cars are good in the draft, three cars are better, and it's going to push Ernie Irvin right up to battle with Earnhardt. Well, we've seen this one.
Oh, here we go. Three abreast coming off the turn. Jarrett decided he wanted to just go ahead and try to lead the race, and Rudd's going to go with him.
Here they come to the trial. Take a look at this. Mark it on your program as lap 110 to the line. 4-1.
Earnhardt.
Back bad. To three.
Bad move by Jarrett. That cost him. He and Irvin cost him both.
Now, Rudd will settle down on the inside. He'll pick one of those guys up and be able to move them back up through, Ned.
Well, he's trying to follow Jared through there, but now Jared slips up in front of Irvin.
And look at Kyle Petty coming. Here's Kyle diving down to the bottom, and he'll try to find a way.
Four breaks. Ricky,
just
Rudd back out of the, here's Sterling Marlin slipping up in there in the car number 8, even though he's laps down, he's still racing.
If you're just joining us, this is live. It's at Talladega, Alabama. It's at over 190 miles per hour. It's coming at the 111 mark as they come by, this time of 188 to be run. For the moment, Bernhard has the lead, Gordon second, Martin third, and the scrimmage continues up there in those front positions. Some 15, 16 cars, I'll take that back. They are showing right now, is this correct, 27 cars for the lead lap?
And they're all in the lead draft.
And all in the lead draft.
And here's Irvin down on the inside once again. He made that move, went by himself down there looking for a partner. Nobody has pulled out with him yet. Running side by side with the car number 16 of Wally Dahlenbach Jr. There's Morgan Shepherd. He's worked his way back up there. Remember, we saw him go to the back when he tried to move a little while back, but he's worked his way back up to 6th now, 7th.
Dahlen back in 12th, and that number 16 had a good day. And that whole field continues to run like a tied-up bundle of sticks back to the stripe.
Made that move and had to get back in line. He lost a couple more positions and said, well, I'll have to get me some momentum build up again, and he'll try it again. Rest assured, you'll see that yellow car dip out from that line as soon as he gets him some momentum build up.
300 miles complete next time by the 500 to be run in the Die Hard race today at Talladega. Going to be a dandy finish.
Race summary is sponsored by Texaco Haviland. Add more life to your car.
Taking a quick look at this race summary, we've got a car spinning at the same time, and it is Michael Waltrip who is in trouble. He's bashed in the fender on the left side. It happened again in turn number 1. We're getting a summary through those first 300 miles, 113 laps. We'll get back to that in a moment. The caution is out for the fourth time today here at Talladega. They're racing back to the stripe right now, and as they do, we'll have Earnhardt in front, Jeff Gordon in second, Mark Martin in third, and everybody is out of the throttle as they come to the stripe. With that many cars, 27 the lead lap, there's not much sense in trying to make up a lap. The only car that would be really a candidate to do that would be Sterling Marlin.
And he was too far back to do it.
Apparently on the radio they were saying it was in one where this incident took place and everybody was lifting. So, fourth caution, and there you see the flag out that the pit road is closed that time by. I think it'll be open next time.
Yes, I think it will be. Another car that was involved in that was Rick Wilson in Richard Petty's car number 44. He went on around, but he has some sheet metal dangling from his car.
So here is Michael Waltrip car coming in, the Pennzoil car. So doesn't look too good on that side either, does it? Got crushed in there on that front. They're beginning to go under to see what they can do about it.
Yeah, it's not the way you want a car to run at 200 miles an hour. You need very slick, the aerodynamics, everything. Let's go to the pits of David Hobbs.
Well, I'm down in the Michael Waltrip pit, and his left front end is stoven in quite a bit, but it's not much below the wheel line. But as you say, aerodynamically, certainly not the best here at Talladega. They're having trouble with the right front wheel, trying to get it under the wheel arch. Maybe there's some damage sustained out there I can't see, but the whole front of the car is looking a bit suspect. Now they're going to try and get the jack under the right side of the car with the, they're all lifting like heck to try and get the jack under. Got that up. A new left front tire going on. The previous one looked very sad as it came off, and they're still trying to drag that bodywork off. They certainly don't want it dragging on the tire going around here. Michael goes off, and really, apart from that little bit of front end damage, the car doesn't look too bad at all.
Well, they rushed to try to keep him in the lead lap, and I think they did. He's going to get out and stay in the lead lap. Let's go back to the pits, and Mike Joy.
Waiting for Dale Earnhardt to come in. He'll be toward the head of that parade. We're going to watch David Smith, the jack man on this car, as they go to the left side for tires. That jack that he has weighs only 35 pounds. Modified racer George Brunholzl builds it, and you see in just 3 pumps, it's up. The first pump gets it up high enough to get the wheel off. The next 2 get it up high enough to get those other wheels on. And Neil Bonnet was trying to get in as Earnhardt was trying. trying to get out, and Neal will have to go around again. He cut to the right to give Earnhardt some running room, so Earnhardt will get track position, and Neal will be at the tail end of the line.
Morgan Shepherd beats everyone out once again in the Wood Brothers Ford. Mark Martin came out second, Dale Jarrett third, Jeff Gordon fourth, and Dale Earnhardt fifth. That's the way they came out of the pits.
Ned, let's take a look at that summary that we had to interrupt with that caution down in turn one. Take a look at where we were as we completed 300 miles of the 500 to be run today. 314 officially completed the time, and it was 9 leaders, 16 lead changes, very slow speed, 152, and 4 caution periods, total of 18 laps is really quoted a little here. Here's the attrition. Bobby Gordon out, Richie Petty's car is gone, Stan Smith, the Horton car, masked, Darrell Waltrip retired, Derek Cope's car is out of competition. That's through 300 miles of the race here today. We have a report that Stan Smith is now in the trauma unit at the Caraway Medical Center in Birmingham, Alabama.
Here's that 44 car we mentioned of Rick Wilson, who was involved with Michael Waltrip. You can see the right front fender is practically gone off of his Pontiac, but he's still, like Michael Waltrip, still able to go.
And the report is no more in detail than what we had for you earlier, that Stan Smith has sustained critical head injuries, and he is in that trauma unit. If there's any update, we'll bring it to you immediately. Here's the pace car coming to the tri-oval. They'll complete 118 laps officially this time by, having 313 miles complete. Mike Joy has more for us.
Well, Ken, now the cars a lap down will come in and pit, and Neal Bonnett, who is on the lead lap, will get to come in.
I think Neal's fault. He's sitting back, he's far back.
So here's Neal in. They're going to get 4 tires on Bonnett's car. He'll be at the tail end of the line of the cars on the lead lap, but he'll have 4 fresh tires as opposed to 2. That should help him gain track position. He's already back there, so they can afford to take that extra time and get the 4 tires. Earnhardt probably lost about 3 or 4 cars on the racetrack due to that little, it wasn't a miscue, it was just a case of Neal trying to get in his pit and Dale trying to leave at the same time. So Neal gave up his own track position in favor of Dale, and it looks like he's popped it out of gear, buzzed the clutch trying to get away from his pits now. Now he selected gear and goes on.
I tore first out of there for us, like a little rookie. I got second. Let me see what all I got.
Well, shifted into that one okay, Neal.
Back to business for Neal Bonnett. Earnhardt will be in 6th on this restart with Shepherd first, Brett Bodine second, Mark Martin third. Let's go to David Hobbs.
Well, Dan and Darrell Waltrip, Michael Waltrip's pit, they're bandaging this car up together with racer's tape and with Pennzoil stickers. They want this car to stay together. They've torn the bodywork, got some holes in it, so they're just patching it up with tape and with the trade stickers to try and make the car get through to the finish. And also, help is aerodynamics. You don't want any bits of bodywork coming apart at 200 miles an hour because the air gets in it, under it, and of course, it's liable to lift the hood right off the car at 200 miles an hour, so you don't want that. So there we see some real frickin' band-aids going on this car, and he still doesn't want to get off that lead lap.
He'll probably get a call from the sponsor about getting those things properly placed.
Yeah, got them upside down, didn't he?
Ford's running 1-2-3. Shepherd, Bodine, Martin, then Dale Jarrett has his Chevy next in 4th, then it's Jeff Gordon in 5th, Dale Earnhardt 6th, Terry Labonte 7th, Schrader 8th, Bill Elliott 9th, Kyle Petty in 10th, front 10. We get a little closer to getting a restart here. It's 1 lap away. 118 laps are complete. 119 when they take green out here.
They still will have to make one more pit stop. Now, Rusty Wallace, who is 3rd in the NASCAR Winston Cup point standings coming into this race, for you fans might be wondering about Rusty. We haven't said a whole lot about him today. He's still on the lead lap, currently being shown in the 14th position.
Pace car back over the field here. We did set to scramble another time.
In fact, 27 cars still being shown.
There's that number 2 car that did such a great job up at New Hampshire International Speedway. Rusty Wallace scoring a victory there 2 weeks ago. Had a great run last week, but Earnhardt beat him. And he stays well up in the point battle.
leads in Cup standings these days. Rusty Wallace, Dale Jarrett, Earnhardt giving it a real go as they move on into the next part of the season. Head up to Watkins Glen, New York to run that road course. Get ready for Darlington on Labor Day. The week after, they're off at Richmond, Virginia. That incredible track. Under the lights there this year. And then it's that great run down the stretch to Atlanta in November.
This is the last race of the year they will run the restrictor plates. Some will be glad of that, probably most of them. Although it makes for some great racing, good close racing.
So we're ready on this restart. This car will drop off, pace car will drop off. Shepherd will lead the field down. Brett Bodine right with him. Huh. Well, that's the way to get it done. 103 degrees doesn't bother that lady one bit, any more than it does Neil Bond.
Well, now Brett Bodine is up there behind the pace car.
Indeed.
So apparently he had gotten out first, and they reshuffled things up there. So Brett Bodine leading, I believe, for the first time today.
Down for the green they come. None of the scoring shows it, but that's the way it shows on the racetrack. And Brett Bodine leads the field down as the Kenny Bernstein Ford. Under green at lap 119, 188 the distance to be covered. Morgan Shepherd having an excellent afternoon, stays right there in that second spot.
Dale Earnhardt got off to a slow start. There's quite a distance between he and the other car. You can see that gap in there. You can see how far it is to the other cars. He'll catch up with them pretty quickly, but unusual for Dale Earnhardt to get a slow start. Now, whether somebody was in front of him that sort of fouled him up, don't know. But anyway, here goes Jarrett and Gordon down on the inside. The two Chevrolets teaming up together, trying to pass that group of Fords.
Dale Jarrett for the lead. Defending Daytona 500-mile champion, Dale Jarrett puts it out in front for Joe Gibbs and company. Jeff Gordon runs out of steam on the bottom.
Yep, he sure did. He just he couldn't clear Brett Bodine when Jarrett did, and it just simply moved him back into the fifth position.
For the moment, it's Jarrett. Here comes Bodine another time. Dale Jarrett working on a third Winston Cup victory. Second in the points to Earnhardt.
Now here is Earnhardt and the car number 24, Gordon, teaming up together down on the inside. So they got a run on him coming off of turn four.
Improvisational dance out here. Earnhardt to go with anybody he can find as a partner to try to get back up with these leaders. Dale Jarrett. This race back in 91 driving for the Wood Brothers, where now Morgan Shepherd sits at the controls. He sure looks like he's in for a better day today.
Cars run well all day for him.
Out of turn two and into the back straightaway. Jeff Gordon picks it up.
And four cars now on that draft down on the inside. That should give them some momentum. Wonder if Jarrett will move down and try to hit them off. No, they're going to go by him on each side going into that turn.
Three wide and Bobby Labonte back in this hunt. Look at this battle. Close.
Very close racing.
Brett Bodine. Lucky racer there. And still three wide as they come through the trioval.
Jarrett's going to go from first to about 15th here. He can't get out of that inside.
He's right in the middle. Inside and outside, they go by him. Got that one right, Ned. He's fallen all the way back. A dozen spots are lost to Dale Jarrett. And Jeff Gordon is in front. Earnhardt is in second. Brett Bodine third.
You see Ken Schrader dicing around. That was the white car that moved up on the outside of Terry Labonte. Greg Saxon, the car number 68, having a good run here today. He stayed right up there in the lead draft.
Earnhardt for the lead. Earnhardt back in front another time. Scoots to the outside. This lets it settle up that racetrack. Skim right up to the wall. Gordon in second. Brett Bodine third. Chevy Ford battle continues to be a tense and tough one here today. Let's
let's not discount what those Pontiacs have been doing. Look at this run at the bottom. Kyle Petty speaking to Pontiacs.
Boy,
with Ricky Rudd in attendance. Goes to the bottom of the racetrack, and he's a man on fire.
He just got a run on Sterling Marlin, who was running there, and moved right around him, and Rudd picked him up. So they'll try to make a move on the inside. Here comes Ernie Irvin behind him. Which line do I follow? Which group? See somebody making a move, they get a good grab, pick up, and they take off. You say, well, maybe I better follow them. Right now, it looks like that Kyle Petty might be a man to follow because he's coming.
Pretty hard not to take the lane. Earnhardt is in, however. He's up there on the outside, but look at Kyle Petty closing on the bottom. Remember, Kyle just took everything here. Back in that May, Winston 500. The four-car train at the bottom, trying to overhaul the Express on the outside. Into the corner, Kyle Petty keeps on picking up those seconds, and he's there.
Again, I think with fresher tires, that inside groove is working. It seems to work better when they have the fresher tires than after the tires get heated up.
Put a lap on Kenny Wallace. Back to the line they come. Even. Earnhardt, half a car, maybe a full car length. Again, Kyle sticks it on the bottom.
And he goes for the lead, and he gets it.
Kyle Petty back in front. Here comes Ricky Rudd, trying to shoot through, and guess who he's got to help him? Ernie Irvin, the number four car, right there.
Masters of drafting. All of these guys are good at it, including Jeff Gordon, who's in his first year in the Whiskey Cup race, and he has become very good at drafting.
Keep an eye on Bobby Labonte back there in that 14 car. Keep an eye on a dozen of them all together. Rather, the 22 car and the 14 car right with him. Terry Labonte and Bobby Labonte are almost even, just behind this pack. Bobby Labonte in the 22 having a great run, and the 14, Terry Labonte, who won here in 89, is right alongside. The brothers even down there now. Kyle Petty still keeps the Pontiac free and clear up in front. Earnhardt in second, run dropped to the bottom as he tries to move in again. Pontiac with a 20-race winless streak at Talladega.
Here's Earnhardt down on the inside once again. Wants Rudd to go with him. Maybe you don't need him. We'll see. I think Rudd's going to follow the Pontiac of Kyle Petty.
In this race, of course, Kyle won here in the Winston 500 earlier this year. This is all a matter of just playing this high-speed chess game, just leaving it on the mat and trying to pick the right spots, right?
That's right. You just put your foot to the floorboard, and that's right. And I hope you pick the right guy to draft with, and hope that you can get an opening somewhere and have enough momentum to go around somebody.
So there it is, Kyle Petty first, Ricky Rudd, and Ernie Irvin, 1, 2, 3. The Diehard 500 from Talladega Super Speedway will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presents the Diehard 500, sponsored by Diehard, the official battery of NASCAR. Smooth Busch beer and easy drinking Busch Light. And by Fisher Nuts. It's Fisher flavor, or it's just plain nuts.
Our thanks to Captain Esch and the crew of the Goodyear Blimp, Stars and Stripes, for the many overhead views of today's coverage of the Talladega Super Speedway, where now 131 of 188 laps are complete, and it's a big war up in front. Ernie Irvin, Ricky Rudd, Kyle Petty, Earnhardt, the front four, as they continue to try to sort this race out.
Caution.
Yellow is back on the track. We got a major crash through the tri-oval. Car on fire coming to the line right here in front of us. It's Ted Musgrave's car, front and rear. And Bonnet's car is also... also involved in the incident. There are four, five cars that have crashed here in the trial, but there is Neil Bonnet's number 31 torn up front and rear. The Musgrave car is torn up. He's told his crew that he is okay. You're in Neil Bonnet's car. After it took a serious hit, you see the crew coming out, some of the safety crew coming out to that car. There's the 55 of Musgrave.
Fireman right Johnny on the spot to put that fire out because it was right in the fuel cell area.
Lap 131. Bonnet's car lies in the grass just at the bottom of the track as you exit pit road.
Wow, his car got upside down. And then comes back on the wheels as we see Musgrave's car sliding up against the wall, flames coming from it as he comes across the start-finish line.
Into the catch fence with the Neil Bonnet car number 31.
You can see the debris, a tremendous amount of it.
From inside of Bonnet's car.
That's the kind of lick that Neil didn't want to take, but look at him, he's crawling out of it. That's good news. All right.
Neil Bonnet, okay. Last race, 1990. A life-threatening crash at that time. He said, I have to come back. I've got to run it one more time.
Didn't want the doctors to tell him he had to quit. He wanted to do it on his own.
Taking a look back at this car number 31, which is the car that Earnhardt had driven in the Firecracker 400 down at Daytona. Neil looks okay. Let's see here as he walks away. Looks like he's okay. Let's listen and look again. Neil Bonnet's incident.
Torn some fence up as the car got upside down, got up into the retaining fence here. Quite a bit of damage to the fence.
The best news of all is he walks away. Fence is all torn up, much like that Bobby Allison crash back here in 1987. And there's the Musgrave car. And it appeared in those pictures that you actually saw the Musgrave car up on the 31. Let's look again here.
Well, there it is.
Right up over Musgrave.
Yeah. Hit by, it looked like the 41 car of Phil Parsons. Or maybe Phil got by and didn't hit him. It looked like he was coming right into it.
So when you saw the Musgrave car from those onboard pictures, Bonnet was upside down, headed for the fence at 190. I don't mean to overstress this 190, but things happen so quickly, so dramatically at this track, at these speeds, and they're going to red flag this event. Red flag is coming out while they do repairs in this fence area for Neil Bonnet's number 31. A red flag is going to be demonstrated to the field as they come by this time. They'll bring them in the position they're running. Musgrave's number 55, stove up, he's out of it. Neil Bonnet walks away, Musgrave walks away. That is the best news of all. Apparently no one up in the grandstand area hurt. We'll wait for any update there is on that story.
And Ken, after Bobby Allison's wreck here back in the mid-80s, they reinforced this catch, what they call a catch fence, that separates the racetrack from the race fence. And thank goodness it has been reinforced because it held him.
And you can see it there, those cables that run along the parallel to the wall itself have been added over the years, and they certainly did their job here.
but there is a red flag on the track. This will come at lap 135. We'll be getting a word from Neil Bonnett in just a moment. After this hair-raising moment at Talladega, Alabama. Stay with us. 25th annual Die Hard 500 from one of the fastest tracks in the world. The Die Hard 500, 25th annual here at Talladega, Alabama, is under a red flag. The race has been stopped. The drivers are clambering out of the cars right now while they continue to work on the fence in the tri-oval area. Take another look at what happened here. That is Neil Bonnett upside down over the top of Musgrave.
Car 55 is Musgrave there, Jimmy Hensley in car number 7. And look at Phil Parsons. Great move. Didn't hit him. He was in that bright yellow-looking car. And you see the car number 55 of Musgrave, that hugs the wall and spins and bangs into it with flames coming from the car.
Now, again, from Neil Bonnett's perspective, as he came to the tri-oval with Dick Trickle behind him, this is what it sounded and looked like to him. Let's go to Mike Joy, standing by with Richard Childress.
Richard, in a wink of an eye, a $100,000 race car is junk. Your comeback driver's on the way to the hospital, and it all unfolded right in front of us standing here. What did you see?
Well, when I turned around, I seen Neil in there. You know, we're not worried about the race car. We got plenty of them, and you can replace them. Our drivers, you know, Neil, we're glad he's okay. I just talked to him, and he said that, you know, he felt real good. Got a bump on his arm. You know, and he was kidding with me about coming in and out of the pit. Said, I won't get in your way no more, I guess, today. I said, well, we're just glad you're okay. But, you know, I'm glad nobody got hurt in it.
The best thing is that's a good, safe race car.
Yeah, you know, we go out of the way to build safe race cars, and all the teams do. And this crash is like that, and like you've seen, that's proof what can happen when you really build a good, safe race car.
Did he give you any indication on the radio what happened? I know he told you he was okay.
No, he thought somebody got into him down there, but he wasn't sure who it was. And when I looked up, he was already in there, you know. And NASCAR does such a super job with the way they put these racetracks together. You can see, you know, the catch fence and everything done its job today. So I'm just glad nobody got hurt in this. Okay.
Thanks, Richard. The debris on the track and the tearing of the fence here has prompted the red flag condition. All the cars are stopped, and of course, they're not eligible to come to pit road and receive any service under this red flag.
And Ken, I believe that somebody did tap him. I don't know if we can see it in this shot as he comes. He's already sideways here. That's Dick Trickle up there on the outside, and he goes up over Ted Musgrave. But it looked like when we were riding with him from the inside, all of a sudden he was just cruising along there in good shape, and all of a sudden the car just went around.
Something turned it.
Yeah, I think he might have gotten a slight tap from somebody as he came through that trial.
Musgrave really lucky. And so is Phil Parsons.
Well, yes. And there's Jimmy Spencer and Dave Marcus.
Dave Marcus in the blue uniform, the SIG on the back.
Like
and
Loy
I think
Allen.
That's Dick Trickle with them as well.
No, I think that's Loy Allen.
Loy Allen, yeah. Correct. Yep. All right, there you see the situation. 134 laps complete here at Talladega. We're back with you at Talladega, Alabama, and the race has been stopped, the Die Hard 500, 25th annual, and you see them working to repair the fence here in the tri-oval area, and it's going to take some time to get this job completed. So while they are fixing the fence in this red flag situation, we are going to go to our coverage today of the Tour de France, and we'll be back with you with more of the race when we're ready to go racing. Right now, here's James Brown. 500, but for the moment, let's return to the Tour de France, and here is James Brown. After about an hour and 8 minutes, we're back with you again at Talladega Super Speedway, and the drivers have been asked to report to their cars. 134 laps have been completed here of the 188, and very shortly they'll send them out. There'll be two or three preliminary laps, and then we'll get back to racing in the 25th annual Die Hard 500. Now, later on today, before CBS Sports leaves the air, you'll see the conclusion of the Tour de France. We're going to stay right here with the race now as we're getting ready to go, unless there was another caution period, Ned.
And then, of course, if there was a long caution period, we'd bring in the balance of the Tour de France. Now, NASCAR has allowed one crew member to go out to the cars with the driver. They can't look at the right side tires, but they can go and help get them buckled in and be sure that the window net is tight and all of that kind of thing. And then they will, they cannot pit when they once leave where they're positioned there now, but once they come around, then the cars in the lead lap will be able to come in for a pit stop.
All right, let's take a look at some of the incidents that have happened here today as they've really been climbing the walls on this racetrack. Let's go back to a bit earlier. This was the first incident. Robbie Gordon down at the bottom has the air taken off his car by the lap cars there. Stan Smith up on the outside, Sterling Marlin. And that was the end of the day for the Robert Yates Racing team.
And it was really a mistake on his part. He got down the left wheels on the flat part of the track, air taken off the spoiler, and it just spun around. And then the big one here.
Here's the big incident going into turn one. Stan Smith's car right there, the black car, is in contact with Horton. Horton rolls three, four times, then over the wall, down the embankment. And you see the white car of Richie Petty, and the black car up against the wall is Stan Smith. The latest reports, they are running CAT scans on him at Caraway Medical Center. At this time, he is in critical condition with head injuries. That's the latest word we have. These were the scenes right after the incident at the infield care center here at Talladega Super Speedway as they moved Stan Smith to take him to Birmingham, Alabama. The other drivers that were involved in that event, that crash, Horton amazingly walked away. Rick Mast was involved, Loy Allen, Jimmy Horton. But Stan Smith, who was making his debut, is the driver in trouble, and here is the remains of Horton's car. And then there was the Neil Boddett incident moments ago that has created this 1 hour delay. Watch the top of your screen as they're coming at 190 into the tri-oval. That's Neil Boddett upside down over Musgrave into the barrier, destroys the car, and Neil Boddett walked away. Musgrave's car. And Neil Boddett has swapped the race seat for a seat up here again. Boy, am I glad to see you.
Yeah, Ken, I tell you what, I wanted to make sure nobody gave my job away up here.
It's a heck of a way to do it.
Oh, man, I tell you, that was, thank goodness these cars are safe as they are.
Isn't it remarkable? Neil, if you of course, haven't seen this, but
that was the first time I've seen it right then.
But there's another shot that you ought to take a close look at. Neil, this is your car from inside in those awful moments when it was out of control.
Sounds just like I remember a while ago. The worst part of something like that is when it gets up in the air and it gets quiet. As long as it's making noise, it's on the ground. And once I heard it get airborne, I was really concerned because, you know, when the things head to the grandstand, you start worrying about the spectators then.
Red flag has been lifted. Yellow is out. Field is back out. You see the pictures from some time ago as Neil staggered away from that race car. I see you got your arm in a sling here.
Yeah, I hit my elbow in the back of my arm on something on the roll bars. I just got some bruises, Kim, but I'm just telling you, these cars are so safe, you know, to do something like that. We work every time there's an accident, they redo the structure of the cars to try to beef them up and, you know, take looks like that and get out and walk away. And, you know, sometimes it's not going to be the kind you can walk away with. Everything impossible you can do is done to these cars.
What do you think happened?
I just felt coming in the tri-oval, I felt just a little bit of a tap, and I felt the back end of the car go around, and I tried to correct to the right, but it was a good and hard enough lick that I felt the rear end come out from under, and then it started lifting off the ground. But first off, let me tell you, since they've dropped this green flag, it's been such tough racing, and you bump and touch and hit people, and there's just no way you can avoid it at these speeds, and there's certainly no one out there that would do it purposely. Mm-hmm. You're going to, racing like this, there's going to be contact every now and then, and you just have to pay the price when it happens.
All right, lap 136, a pit stop topping some tanks here. They still can't get home from here.
I believe.
It would be stretching it awfully far. There might be somebody that will try to go that far, but I think most of them are going to have to come in for at least a dash of fuel. Now, the cars that are in the lead lap are pitting now. They will take another lap, and those that are one or more laps down will be able to come in, make their pit stops, and then we should be able to get to green flag condition shortly after that.
Did you realize you were going upside down?
I knew when it cleared the ground and it got quiet that I wasn't, as long as the tires were squealing, it was okay. But when it got quiet, I knew it went up. And the last thing I saw out of the corner of my eye was the grandstands. And I said, man, I don't need to get up there. You know, it's bad enough to have an accident with some race drivers. We sure don't need to get up in those grandstands. And I think since the accident that Bobby Allison almost did this season,
87.
Every one of these racetracks have put up stress, really emphasized, you got to credit the people that own these tracks for building them up to hold them in there.
Here's Mike Joy.
Again, among the cars waiting to restart, if Cinderella's slipper could be made of Nomex and leather and have a Simpson patch on it, Bobby Labonte might be wearing it. Bill and Gail Davis owned that race car, had to take a provisional, started 41st, missed the show, car ran like a turtle in qualifying.
Yeah, there you go.
He got up to sixth place here. He's in sixth in the draft when they waved this red flag. What's the difference?
Well, I wish I knew. The car just will not run by itself. But, you know, right at the end of practice yesterday, we changed carburetors. And, of course, today we've got the grill open for more air. And it seems to have made a heck of a difference. It still won't run out front. It still won't run by itself. But it drafts great.
Well, this is a place for rookie winners. Gail, what's more nerve-wracking, watching that car, yours, right up toward the front, or watching our buddy Neil Bonnickel sailing through the air here?
Well, that was pretty exciting. I was very afraid there, but it's an exciting day for us to come from so far back to up front.
There were some long faces in that garage early this morning, but they've turned around now. Bobby's one of these 20-some drivers has a good shot to win this thing.
Well, thank you, Mike. If Bobby Labonte can pull off a victory from that 41st starting spot today, it'll be the furthest back that anybody's come since back in the 50s, back in maybe 53 when Fonte Flock won the Raleigh 300. He started 43rd that day, and I was just thinking the furthest back anyone has ever come to win in this race was Richard Brooks. I think he came from 24th when he pulled it off. So Bobby Labonte, as a rookie, is doing a whale of a job out here.
He certainly is, Kent. You know, we speculated there a moment ago that about everyone would have to make another pit stop. Let's look back, way back in the race. Bill Elliott made his first pit stop on lap 49. Now, the others had pitted a little bit earlier. We made mention of the fact that he had a radio problem, then they finally got NASCAR to post his number on the board for him to come in to the pits. Okay, so they ran two pace laps, so that's a total of 51 laps. When he made his pit stop there just a moment ago, there were 52 laps to go. Can he stretch it one more than that? Can anybody else do it? Well, time will tell. Some will try.
Stay
tuned. Rest assured.
Stay tuned. Here's David Hobbs.
I'm with Joe Gibbs, owner of Dale Jarrett's car. Normally, you should be going to Carlisle, Pennsylvania, open training season. Is this exciting enough alternative for you, Joe?
Well, I enjoy this right now. I'm out of the heat. At least I can go in here and get a drink instead of telling the guys and faking it, saying I'm tough and you got to stay out there and go after it.
Well, Dale's been up and down. He came from the middle of the pack, came right to the front, slipped back to 20th, then he was up to 6th before the check at the red flag. How do you think he's going to do this afternoon? And can you make it without stopping again, do you think?
Well, I think this is a redefinition of the word friend. You're really finding out. Today, we can't find many. I think we got a chance to make it. I think several other cars do, too. I want to say hello to my mom. She's in the hospital.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good luck this afternoon and, of course, to Dale.
25 cars remain in the lead lap. There are now 137 laps complete. One lap and we will be racing. 1 hour, 10 minutes, 8 seconds in a red flag condition after this crash in the tri-oval area that brought Neil Bonnett back to the booth.
Maybe for a long time.
Maybe getting some sand out of your eyes still?
Yeah, trying to see what's still hurting is gaining on me now. They're getting sore.
When do you really get sore after a crunch like that?
Probably it takes tomorrow you'll be sore, and then the next day, and my neck's already getting a little bit sore, but I'll take the soreness right now.
You said you couldn't wait to do it because it was so much fun. I mean, here you were upside down into that wall.
Well, it was fun up till then. I was telling you all along I was enjoying myself, but it got real good. I was having a ball till that sudden stop, and then after that, it wasn't fun anymore.
Do you want to officially announce your retirement here, Bonnett?
I've opened my mouth before and changed feet. I don't want to try it again.
All right.
That'd probably be it right there. I doubt seriously Richard Childress let me borrow another car.
Mike Joy on Pit Road.
While Ned had his calculator out, I went running for Mike Beam, who's Bill Elliott's crew chief. And he said on that first run you talked about, Ned, 49 green and two caution laps, they only use 19 and a half gallons. So he says they're done making pit stops if they go green the rest of the way. He says it's their only chance to beat the Chevrolets today is to stretch it out on gas mileage. They're going for it.
I think they will.
You know, that's unique about racing, Ned. You plan all your strategy and you do everything you can do, and then a radio doesn't work and it shows you how far you can go. That thing giving them trouble possibly showed them that they can go further than anybody else, so they're in good shape.
100 degrees, nobody's ducking for shade or their cars or the air conditioning. These real fans out here, they've waited an hour to see this one get cranked up again, and we're ready to go racing at Talladega, Alabama. They'll come by with 139 of the 188 laps complete. Talladega is where Terry Labonte said is the only track where you finish closer than we start. We'll see how it comes out today. The last 13 races here, starting back in 89, they run twice a year. Labonte beat Cale Yarborough, Dale Earnhardt, Benny Parsons by a car length. Finishes have been just remarkable. Total margin of victory in the last several races, just 4 seconds. That's total over 13 years in this race. All right, we're going. In the back straightaway. Urban has it. Rudd is right there. Guess who it is down on the inside, trying to move himself right back up into this thing.
That yellow that car is Phil Parsons, who is
a lap down.
Right. So you see those first seven cars have pulled out a little bit ahead of the other cars. That Strickland's running in eighth place. He's the red car there. You see Dale Jarrett and a couple of other cars get to the inside, trying to make a move down there.
All day long protecting that outside lane out there. If they get outside of it, you got to move down to it. That everybody's afraid to get out of line until they get somebody to work with them.
There you see seven cars have pulled away a little bit from the eighth place car of Hunt Strickland. But now the cars, Hunt Strickland has Bobby Hillen and Mark Martin on his bumper, so now they're beginning to make move here.
Down to the inside. I want to correct one thing earlier. We're talking about the race back here in May. That was Ernie Irvin all the way. Kyle Petty had a great, incredible run at Daytona. Oh, he's out of this draft. Look at him fall back for a moment. Now he's getting a little assistance.
Bobby Labonte pulled down to go with him.
Earnhardt getting some help on the outside. Bill Elliott there.
It almost looked like Kyle, when Labonte saw Kyle was able to hold Earnhardt even all the way around, he says, maybe I get in and go with him, we can do it.
Now Dale Jarrett has pulled down there with him. He had a good run going into the turn, so he's pulled down there to see if he can pick up a few positions.
141 now complete, and that trio on the inside beginning to wind them in from Earnhardt's view.
Single fine. They got away from that secondary pack. They keep this up, that secondary bunch will be right in it again.
Earnhardt's trying to debate whether to pull down in front of Kyle and go with him. He decided he'd stay up there in that outer groove.
And it looked like Kyle's nipping at him so bad, he said, maybe I need to go with him.
Yeah.
Kyle's car showing a lot of strength on that inside.
Well, usually after they have pitted and put on a couple of tires, it seems the inside groove works pretty good for a while. We've seen that in the past in the race here today.
Urban first, Rudd second, Earnhardt third, Kyle Petty down on the inside and fourth.
He's gotten up to Earnhardt, and that's as far as he can go right now. Now they've pulled away just a little bit to try to get down. Now they can move back up in there, but they want to get a little bit of clean air down there to see if they can get a run.
You know, Dale Jarrett's coming right in behind these guys, Labonte. If he could close it, boy, he got lost back there a little bit. He was up behind them. If he could pull up there behind 22, three of them, Mike could do it.
Yeah, he got lost back there for some reason. He was up there with them. But
the two rookies, Bobby Labonte, running side by side with Gordon as Richard Petty looks on.
The only cowboy hat in the country with a microphone on it, I guess. Some strength. That inside lane just sitting there plugging away at him.
Ken Schrader's had a car problem in car number 25. He was up there in that lead draft, has dropped off the pace and was going very slow down the back straightaway while Kyle Petty continues to try to move around.
Behind him is Bobby Hillen in ninth. The Junie Donlevy car still looking for its first top 10 finish of the year, and Bobby Hillen has it up there right now.
I'll tell you what, the two of those guys, with Kyle Petty and Bobby Labonte, they've made one car linked up. They've got completely clear past Earnhardt, and now they're trying Rudd.
And you've got to respect Bobby Labonte for hanging down there on that inside right behind Kyle Petty, and they are just barely inching up there.
Schrader Petty.
Yet when that was happening, we saw an opening on the right side there, and they didn't jump in it. They're going to keep that buddy system going.
Field is in turn three, and here comes Kyle, ready to challenge, and Bobby Labonte in assistance with the number 22. The rookie, Bobby Labonte, looking for his best career finish.
Kyle slips out almost into Rudd coming off the turn.
He had a lift just a tad.
I doubt it.
He
did.
He just almost slipped out. Hard to lift.
Yeah.
I tell you what's crazy, from the time they dropped the green flag on the go to you pit, you're on the floor.
He never lived?
He never came to the draft. It's not to the point now where you can get up and roll out of the throttle. You draft flat on the floor. Heard a lot of drivers talking about it, and I was amazed today how you just very seldom can get it off the ground.
Burn piston in car number 25 put Schrader on pit road.
Well, I wondered how many cars would be affected by that long wait. They had the cars all heated up, and then they sat out there and cooled down. I'm sure they did put the oil cooler, I mean, the oil heater on the cars, but still, you wonder how it affects them.
That thing, that's a big change on that engine center cooling down. They like to crank these one time and use them up.
Yep. Here comes, could be a change for the lead. That's Kyle Petty. Yeah, he had by about a foot when he came across the start finish line.
146 now complete. Here's Mike.
Ken, I've talked to the crew chiefs of all the top six cars, and all but one said they can go the distance comfortably on this tank of gas. That crew chief said, we can't make it, but we're going to act like we can. Won't tell you who he is.
We heard in the background that somebody's motor was blowing, and that was from a radio.
Yeah, but I saw car 24 in the back. Gordon dropped to the inside, so he was right up there, and I think he's fell back. There he is on the inside, way in the back of this pack, just to the... There's another car. There's the 40. Maybe he had to live for that car, but the 24 lost the draft, too.
Leaders. Battle for the lead continues. The Diehard 500 will continue after this word from your local station.
This is CBS.
Working lap 149. And Dale Earnhardt switches to the inside as Kyle Petty moves in front. Ernie Irvin in second. Bobby Labonte down there needs to find a place to hide in that outside line now, not get left out.
There's Jeff Gordon, who had made that pit stop, came out in front of the leaders, gets completely down out of the way.
That's what I was interested to see. Would Kyle bear with the 22? Stick with him on that inside. Yeah, he could have moved up and had to leave, but he 22 helped him get there. He's going to find it out with him.
Hey, that's very gentleman of him to do that.
See, he could actually be leading the race in that outside lane, but the 22 helped him get there. And he didn't want to just
not come leave him alone.
Throw him in the ditch. He's bringing him with him.
The two Hendrick cars, the 25 and the 24, had trouble within one lap of each other. Schrader behind the wall, and now a lap down. The 24, Jeff Gordon comes back out. And look at this battle for the lead.
He goes up in there, he's going to make it three wider. His car just drifted up there, Neil. He probably couldn't help that. He just got pulled up there with the air.
Looks like he made a big slide up in there. In that inside lane, usually they'll go by you on both sides.
Yeah.
But Strickland's way down low. Earnhardt's trying to get a hold of those cars in front of him, but usually when you caught them, you're caught in the middle, you're going back.
Yep. Yeah, you don't get much draft help when you're down there. And you certainly don't have much steering room there either. Earnhardt's caught up there on the outside now as others go by down on the inside. Here's Greg Sachs down on the inside of him. Now Dale Jarrett slips up in front of him.
Looks like Kyle Petty is saying, come on, Labonte, now you help me get here, but I can't stay on that inside forever.
I think he gave it up. I think he decided to better get up there and do his own thing out front.
First to 16th, 1 3/10 of a second.
There's Earnhardt going by Jarrett, putting him in the middle.
Strickland trying to help Labonte. That's two forwards down on the inside. They'll play that system with a different. Now look here, there's Kyle Petty. He said, buddy, I hate to left you back here. Let me drop in here and give you a little bit of help. He pulled down, trying to pick that 22 car back up.
for long, however. Labonte down there again by himself on the inside.
He had Greg Sack coming up, but Greg moved up behind Ricky Rudd. So Labonte is there. Boy, that car is strong.
Isn't that incredible?
Staying down there by himself.
But, of course, he's come from a provisional starting position from 41st, so they've got something there.
I saw Jarrett down on that inside, three deep. It looked like he got a good run coming off turn two.
See him in the picture yet, so don't know where Greg got it. There he is.
There he is, dropped the box.
He kind of got caught in the center, like he was talking about that shovel. It looked like he picked up a little bit of help here.
Bobby Labonte's number 22.
Now that inside's beginning to hurt him a little bit as the outsiders go by, unless Jarrett can get up there to him.
I'll tell you what, he's doing a heck of a job holding his own. He's losing about a car length of the lap.
Have to pinch it a little going into one. Whoop, almost up into the five.
Yeah, he sees that little opening between the four and the five, and I guarantee he'd give you anything to get that real estate. He says, if I can just get in some hole around here, I can race these guys.
Well, this is looking almost like the last couple of laps here in May when they turned them loose with just a few laps to go and everybody beating and banging and switching positions, and they're switching positions back in there.
I'm kind of surprised that not anyone jumped in there with Labonte, as good as that thing of his is running. Here comes a crew right behind him. Didn't have much choice. That's the side they're on. And they get to it. We'll see if they can work their way in.
We're in the last 100 miles. Nosing down toward the finish of this one. 152 laps complete, 404 miles down. Look at that struggle. Hut Strickland now in the middle.
Now Labonte has moved up into the outside group.
Fourth. Leader continues to be Kyle Petty. Has that Pontiac out in front. In second, Ernie Irvin. And third is Ricky Rudd. The fourth spot. Sachs falling back into fifth and up into fourth. Bobby Labonte from the 41st position. More from the Die Hard 500 shortly. There are 156 laps now complete. The man on the move is Greg Sachs. He's flying through traffic. You see Ernie Irvin out in front. Sachs has just come into second place.
He has made some gutsy moves. He passed Bobby Labonte up on the outside, went around Kyle Petty in second place. That car is on the move. But here comes Kyle Petty. He's on the move too.
Kyle Petty into that second spot. We'll be showing you the final segment of that Tour de France coverage later today. It's coming up later here on CBS. We wind down this 25th annual Die Hard 500. Ricky Rudd's car number 5, you don't see it in the picture, it just a lap ago fell off the pace. So that means that all three Hendrick cars had a problem with one about 10 laps of each other. Rudd was running right there in the top 5, and then it just went away. Here it is, well off the pace. Bottom of the racetrack now, falling out of the lead lap.
Every one of them apparently having engine problems, and we said that that long wait could affect somebody.
And you said that Dale Jarrett had one of those engines from Hendrick today?
That's the Hendrick Motorsports engine. Yeah, that's all he runs, is the Hendrick Motorsports engines.
It's running, because he's been fighting that inside as tough as anybody.
He's been picking off one at a time, getting back up there. He dropped back to about 12th to 13th, but now back up there trying to take over 5th.
Well, it looked like Labonte came down. I thought Labonte was going to go with him. I don't know if he knew Dale was that close.
I don't think so. Dale had to back out of the problem.
Earnhardt has led 55 laps today. Irvin 50. That 5-point bonus for leading the most laps. Irvin continuing to lead right now. Kyle sits second. And Greg Sachs still having a fine race. Here's Mike Joy.
Robin Pemberton, Kyle Petty's crew chief, told me it doesn't matter much whether Kyle leads or if he's in the draft, but his car is working very well on the bottom. The problem is the majority wants to run the top lane, and it's majority rule around here until you get down to a couple laps to go. Let's go to David Hahn.
Gary DeHart, what's up with Ricky Rudd's car, do we know?
David, right now we think we're probably dropping the valve, but we're not sure.
I see Hendrick Motors in just a few laps. Is there any significance on that? Was it that long stop, you think?
It could have been. Anytime when you heat something up like that and cool it back down, it could have a problem.
Tough day at Talladega.
Another car that has fallen back is Elliott. He scrubbed right up to the wall a little while ago, and he has been falling back out of this lead group. Bill Elliott in the Junior Johnson Ford, which is set on the pole. He's back out of that front group, back to about 18th at the present time. Bobby Hillen has taken himself into fifth. He's right behind the front four.
And Greg Sachs has gotten himself into position. He dropped back. A bunch of cars have gone around him in the last lap.
It looked like he was going to try to make one move, and he got out of line. And boy, look here, he's about eighth or ninth place now.
That really cost him.
Terry Labonte down there along with the 16 guard. They're going to give that inside a run now.
Hillen to the outside, stretching for another position, right up on the outside. 12 cars in the lead draft.
Well, the Junie Donlavey crew have got to be on their feet and some big smiles on their face. Best run they've had this year. They ran off the good in the Daytona 500, got caught up in a wreck. But Bobby Hillen ran very well there. They were looking forward to this race.
How stout that 22 is, though, Ned. Back comes that Bobby Labonte on the inside. Brett Bodine trying to give Hillen a little help here. From the back of Earnhardt's car, take a look at that fight. That's the Junie Donlavey car on the outside, number 90. Ran second in this race way back in 72 for the old Kia Cup Chief, Ramos Stott.
Boy, Labonte was able to slide up in that open. That's going to help him.
That was the year James Hilton came to victory. Libby Carr really running well here today. Of course, Bobby Hillen, his only victory was here, 86. 86, when he pulled that big upset with the Stavolis. Still Urban leading, Kyle Petty second. Inching his way along, Earnhardt finds himself in third. We're on the 2.6-mile high banks at Talladega, Alabama, where a decision is to be rendered in about 26 laps.
CBS Sports presentation of the Die Hard 500 has been sponsored by Die Hard, the official battery of NASCAR. Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by Goodyear, number one in tires.
We're back, 438 miles complete. 165 laps this time by gets us to 438. The Goodyear blimp giving us these great shots. Stars and Stripes based out of Pompano Beach, Florida. At the controls, Captain Dick Ash from Sunrise, Florida. Neil Bonnet and Ned Jarrett here at the booth. They have Neil back with us, Ken Squire here, and David Hobbs, Mike Joy down there for whatever is going to happen on pit road in these final moments. Playing that card close to the vest for that final pit stop, trying to make it home.
And then he won't have to stop.
Yeah, we almost just overlooked that, but it's going to be close with some of those guys.
Yes.
We heard Robin Pemberton talking about Kyle Petty's car a while ago, how good it ran on the bottom. The last couple of laps, he drove right to the bottom and pulled away from those guys a little bit. He's kind of testing that car. Look what a run he can get on those guys when he takes that bottom lane. And I don't know if that's going to be enough cushion on that last lap to hold that group up behind him. It takes him virtually that back straightaway to reel him in.
And as you see, they've shuffled them another time. You now have Kyle Petty first, Dale Earnhardt second, Ernie Irvin is found third, Bobby Labonte is fourth, Hillen fifth, and in sixth is Brett Bodine, Dale Jarrett seventh, Mark Martin eighth, Terry Labonte right in that group.
And those nine cars, Ken, have pulled away a little bit from the pack of cars behind them.
Nine car lead draft. Here's Mike Joy.
Tim Brewer is the veteran crew chief for rookie Bobby Labonte. He's with Junior Johnson for a long time. He's going to clock his car as he comes past. Here's the start-finish stripe. Radio the time to Bobby right in the middle of that lead pack. Tim, where would you like him to be in that pack?
Behind Ernie Irvin or Kyle, either one of them. You know, the car runs pretty good. And those guys today, they've been kind of looking out for Bobby a little bit. So either one of those two guys would be a pretty good guy to run with. But don't expect no friends here on the last lap. I got a feeling you couldn't find one.
Well, now Kyle has told us that his car works real well on the bottom, and it looks as if Bobby does too.
Our car ran on the bottom awful well earlier today. You know, they're out there just kind of playing with each other right now. I don't know who needs to be where, but, you know, our car runs real well with Ernie or Kyle, so that's the place I'd like to see.
Brewer's a poker player. I know he knows more than he's telling.
Trained by Richard Childress in the old days. And then, of course, Junior Johnson.
Yeah, there's a couple of masters. He spent there, didn't hurt me.
Started out in Grand American ranks with Childress back when Richard was a driver. Bobby Hillen still hanging tough in fifth, and that Brett Bodine looks good in sixth. First pack to second pack. Front nine is about, from this group back to the next group, about 2 4/10 of a second. So if they start racing each other side by side, there's a pretty good chance, as we saw yesterday. It was amazing. Michael Waltrip pulled up to run beside Earnhardt. Two laps to go. There was a group of four cars that were almost 300 feet behind them. And on the end of that group was that kid LaJoy. LaJoy wound up. And those two started to run together up in front, Waltrip and Earnhardt. LaJoy, that whole pack caught up, and LaJoy tried to run Earnhardt down the line. It was a heck of a finish, and it can happen here.
Well,
dice it, but I don't think they will.
Well, I don't think so. There you see Terry Labonte is about to lose the draft of that group of eight up in front of him. He is just about too far behind now to catch up by himself. So that second pack of cars probably will catch him.
See that line that Kyle Petty takes where he's just a shade down from everybody else out of two? Gets a good scoot and he's right back out there in line as he goes down that long back straight.
Good option to do that. If somebody follows him down there, there's a good chance somebody behind them will go high around him. So he's got that option to get in there low. Some of these other guys, they can't do that. They drop low, somebody drop on the top side of them, and they lose that position.
You saw Dale Jarrett pull out there to make a challenge.
Well, they just passed Brett Bodine coming off of that turn, and they're about to lose the draft of those top four. They aren't careful.
The top four took advantage of it.
Yep.
You know, it's crazy. One lap, just some discipline between them front leaders, and I'm telling you, they can get away.
Now, yesterday in practice, Bobby Hillen and Dale Jarrett hooked up together and ran some 195, 196 mile an hour laps. So that's the position they're in right now. Let's see if they can catch back up to that group.
18 laps to go.
You got the guys up front playing defense, and the guys in the rear, they're on offense. They're trying to get up there, but these two cars, no, they're closing them back in there, man, just like
they're
you're saying.
Back. Those cars work well together.
90 car in fifth, the 18 car Jarrett in sixth. Trying to close down on these leaders. Kyle Petty, Earnhardt, Ernie Irvin, and Bobby Labonte driving the Winston Cup race of his life. David Hawkins.
Okay. I'm with Doug Williams, Bobby Hillen's crew chief. He's running real strong right in the last part of this race.
David, we feel right happy right now. The Pilot Byers Ford Thunderbird hauling the furniture right now. We just hope we can stay in line and keep our position. We'll have a good finish.
Where do you want it to be on those last two or three laps?
Right where we're at, we're pretty well pleased. You know, we're going to let the furniture jockey around a little bit and we'll see what happens.
Is that 40 horse got the power to win this race?
We feel like it does. We're still going to pull for it anyway. Leave it up to the good Lord.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, David.
The good Lord and Bobby Hillen.
That's right.
Bobby's going to have a whole lot to do with that.
Dale Jarrett looking him over on the inside, pulls back in line.
They did shake Terry Labonte off the end of that field. Yep. They'd like to shake a few more off before they get it down and get as few cars as they can, but this group we've got here, all of them are plenty strong to stay in it.
Yep, you got eight cars there now, and that second group of cars, which is led by Morgan Shepherd, is about to catch Terry Labonte now.
Yeah, they possibly could get up and go again. Kyle's car seems to be so good down low. When he turns down there, he pulls away. And that's amazing that he's got the strength to just get him a little distance right there.
And he does it in that second turn all the time. But here's Earnhardt catching him up.
I'll tell you what, that second turn, it's nice to have a lead. But when you come off turn four, with this start finish line all the way down here in turn one, you need that lead coming off turn four.
Martin made a pass on Brett Bodine coming off of turn four.
Gets him a spot.
Moves him up to seventh. And Bodine's going to have a tough time hanging on to the draft. He's back about three car lengths. He's going to have to hustle to stay up there with him. He has nobody behind him to help him. You can see there that those three or four car lengths that he's behind, he might be able to, I believe he is going to be able to pick back up. Yep, there he comes down the back stretch. He's picked that draft right back up. Good drive.
The interval from this pack of eight to the next group back now stands at 5 seconds as they drive a very smart race out here and wait it out.
Less than 15 laps to go.
14 when they come by. There's Irvin just sneaking a peek, then drops back in.
Every one of them sitting there. Now, what do I need to do to pass that guy in front? What's that car up there going to do that's going to help me or hurt me?
The tough part about it, you'll kind of get you a game plan, and you'll make your move, and nobody else will do anything you want to do. Everything in a big scramble, but I guarantee you these guys are plotting it right now.
There you see that second pack coming to the stripe.
Oh.
Yeah, Jared. Yep, right up on the top side around Bobby Hillen. That's going to take the sixth car with him around there.
For fifth.
Hillen tried to pull in. Looks like they got together on the back straightaway. Where did they go?
Brett Bodine, it maybe touched a little bit.
Looked like they got together. I don't see them on the tail end of that draft. I don't know if it shook them loose. Yep, they got together a little bit when he tried to come up. It looks like it's going to break them off the lead.
Well, if Brett Bodine could get a little help from Hillen, that could get him back in here. There is time for them to catch him back up if they start racing up in front here.
Yep. I don't think we're going to see a lot of passing up front there for another few. Well, just as I say that, look at Dale Jarrett up on the outside.
Well, around Bobby Labonte.
And yeah. Mark Martin coming right with him.
That's the way Dale Jarrett's car, that was the strength of his car at Daytona Beach, Florida, when he won the 500. He was able to drive around him in the corner and just take that position away.
Well, he's done it here again.
Dropping down to the inside and shuffled right back into that group.
And what did that do for Brett Bodine and Bobby Hillen? They're still pretty far back.
There they are.
There's Brett's in a better position. Hillen's one that's about to lose the draft.
Brett's in the agency, kind of inching forward, trying to make it come on, baby, pull on back up there.
Got good thing to the floorboard.
He's on the verge of losing that draft.
Ninth is Morgan Shepherd. Going 10th is Bodine, 11th is Dahlenbach, 12th is Sachs. And Terry Labonte is in 13th. Bill Elliott back in 14th. Gant behind him.
And boy, I'll tell you, they are doing some racing in that second pack. They're running three abreast going into turn one.
There's that second group. There you see Jeff Bodine in the Bud Moore car.
Terry Labonte up there in the black and white car. He was in the lead draft a while back, but we noted that he had lost that draft.
Sachs in between them. And here comes Sachs after Bodine.
Yes, Sachs was running second just a while ago. Moved right up into second position and tried to make a pass or got caught on the inside. It's all the way back to the second group.
This is for ninth. 177 of 188 complete this time by. And the leaders are there.
Bobby Hillen has lost the draft, and Brett Bodine has just about lost the draft of the lead group as well. Now there are six up front. This is the second pack of cars just across the start-finish line going into turn one. Here are those six cars that are in the lead pack. Kyle Petty, Dale Earnhardt, Ernie Irvin, Dale Jarrett, Mark Martin, and Bobby Labonte.
I tell you, when they come around this time, there's going to be 10 laps to go. We're going to get out here in just a minute and find out what they're going to do.
Pontiac, Chevy, Chevy, Chevy. Ford and Ford, fifth and sixth.
Who has enough gas to make it? It's going to be close. Some will
and a couple will. And I'll tell you something that might enter into this. If one of those cars runs out of gas and slows the guys behind him down, they're out of it too. If one of these cars runs out, whoever's behind him is going to pay that same price because they're going to have to lift and dodge him. The leaders are going to get away. It's also a pretty tricky situation to run out in front of somebody at 180 miles an hour without getting run over. Used to, we'd see these guys in the draft when they were concerned about fuel mileage, want to get back there in second place. Now they contend to us that they can get just as good a mileage in front. And that must go back, Ned, to that part where you just leave it on the floor where you're at.
Yep. Back to the floorboard, it doesn't matter whether you're in front or in second place.
Not only that, that guy up front is getting a lot better fuel mixture, getting clean air going in that carburetor. He might actually get better mileage.
Well, he might do it. Plus the fact that the cars back in there might occasionally have to back off a little bit. And every time you pat that accelerator, you put a little bit more fuel through it.
Yeah, those quarters kick in and give that little extra shot. The extra shot right now is what you don't need.
A year ago here, Kyle Petty finished in sixth when Ernie Irvin came home first. That number four car, Sterling Marlin, then was in second. Bill Elliott had himself a great run that day. Brought it home in fifth, just in front of Kyle. For the moment, Kyle has the advantage, coming around a complete 180 this time.
Ernie Irvin getting a little bit itchy.
Yeah, he's thinking outside.
Yeah, he was.
Pontiacs have scored six wins in 17 races this year. And a pretty good season of it for the moment. Kyle Petty has him up in front of that Chevrolet contingent.
Eight laps go.
Mark Irvin and Jarrett. Then the Ford, Mark Martin right there. From Earnhardt's viewpoint.
See, Kyle ran a little higher that time. A little different landing I saw before. Well, I tell you what Kyle Petty's wanting is this four car, it's three to get the racing behind him. What he doesn't need is both of them to work on him. It's going to be a scramble at the end.
Jarrett drove back a little bit on that last lap, slipped a little bit in the turn. It's like he's catching back up a little bit. There's Irvin. Looks like he's trying that. He's looking up there. He's testing the waters up there just to see how the car sticks and what kind of a run he can get off of that turn.
Water looks deep to me up here.
Seven to go.
Stepped in, almost went over your head there.
A reminder, we'll be bringing you the conclusion of the Tour de France following our coverage of the Die Hard 500 here this afternoon. Mike Joy.
Well, as the laps are ticking, so is that fuel meter, if there would be one, in Kyle Petty's car. Car owner Felix Savatis and crew chief Robin Pemberton are conferring, and they say they are within a lap of being able to go the distance. That means either they're going to come up a lap short or they're going to be coughing on fumes when they get to the line, but they're not stopping.
After a day like today, no stopping energy for this.
No, you just run her till she runs out. That's all you can do.
Stop now, you're going to lose over a lap anyway.
Yep.
It's run her out, finish it,
take what you get.
David Hawks.
Well, I just spoke to Larry McClure, the owner of Ernie Irvin's car, about 10 laps ago, and he told me there was no way they were going to stop and they could make it easy. But, of course, as Neil Bonner pointed out, if one of those front cars runs out of gas, who knows, that second group may yet steal the prize here at Talladega. So it's really nip and tuck. They all say they can make it, but some say they can't.
Look at Earnhardt trying that high line with Irvin. Kyle's down low. They're playing some chess right now. They're shuffling them around some different places on the track.
Earnhardt victorious yesterday. A year ago, Irvin won on Saturday, came back, won on Sunday. Earnhardt would like to duplicate that today. Here he is, moving to the inside, taking a look on the bottom.
I think he's sitting there with a grin on his face right now. He wants to beat him, whether he can do what he thinks he can do, I don't know. They're coming up on a big bunch of cars, lap cars. Don't know how that might affect things, but there are about five cars in front of them there that they will pass before this race is over.
And five to go, too.
And Ernie Irvin keeps looking on the outside, keeps climbing higher on the bank. This time, Earnhardt goes with him. Back straight away. All the way on the bottom is Kyle Petty, where he's been almost every lap. And now you're riding with Earnhardt as he closes in another time.
Well, Kyle Gaines, as Neil has pointed out several times, coming off of that turn, but Earnhardt running higher. He has a little bit more momentum coming off of that turn and pulls up on him.
It did. I just saw some kind of hand signal back to the four car. I don't know what that was all about. I didn't know if he ran up on him. Look at Earnhardt's car wiggling right there.
Boy, it really is. That's the second time he's done that coming off of turn four.
And it's probably the standard deal with drivers when you come up on traffic. You throw your hand up, you let them know you're coming up. That's probably what that move was.
Through lap traffic. Michael Waltrip, Jimmy Means,
Dick Trickle.
Yeah, they need to clear this traffic where they don't have to deal with this.
And here comes Irvin down on the inside of Dale Earnhardt. He's coming on traffic, but he couldn't make the pass. He thought he had him there for a moment, but just couldn't quite do it. Here comes Earnhardt now, and Irvin gonna come with him.
2.5 laps to go.
Boy, they're gonna hang Kyle out. It's gonna leave that whole inside line right there. Maybe that hand signal I was talking about wasn't traffic. Maybe they set it up. You know, a lot of times you'll wave and say, point to the back straightaway until I got, let's make the move this lap.
Earnhardt singing Come Dance With Me to Ernie Irvin. And Irvin came right with him.
Three Chevrolets out front.
Jarrett goes to third. Chevy up in front. Kyle's Pontiac drops to fourth. Mark Martin stays right there in that fifth spot, and Bobby Labonte in sixth.
Well, I bet you one thing, Kyle Petty's move will be to the bottom. If Jarrett goes to the bottom under and the 42 goes with him, they got a strong car to work that bottom lane.
And look at Earnhardt begin to use the backstretch. Earnhardt has led 56 laps. Irvin has led 56 laps in this event. Down to it.
But look at Irvin closing in turn three and four. That's where this long front straightaway with the start finish line way down here turn one is going to play into this.
It's a little bit like he played in Daytona, remember? Earnhardt out in front, and within striking distance was Jarrett in that last shuffle.
It'll be tough for him to make those same moves and make it work here today, unless he has a whole lot more than I think he has left in that Chevrolet.
There's your one down.
There's Kyle.
Oh, down the inside.
Yep.
And we We saw him do this before. We saw him come from back there up to the front, but he had some help. Jared's thinking about giving him that help.
He's thinking about it.
Which lane do I go with?
Yeah.
And boy, look here now. While they're doing this, Earnhardt's getting him a little breathing room.
Well, that's the best thing could happen to Dale Earnhardt for those guys to get to racing back there side by side.
Gives him 10 car lengths.
The only thing about that, now if they get back in single file, they'll eat him alive that far out there by himself.
Yeah, because they'll get a big run on him.
Ernie just doesn't want to give it up, nor does Kyle.
And here comes Jarrett down on the inside.
White flag coming out this lap. There's Kyle Petty up there. He's the strongest guy in that bunch. Looks like there's a chance to run on Earnhardt. And there he goes to the inside.
Final lap. Kyle drops to the bottom. Urban goes up on top. Kyle pushes it hard.
I guarantee Urban's going to go three wide to the bottom with Jarrett. There's that bottom lane open for him.
This is the run for the money. Last lap. Urban there on the inside. Earnhardt on the outside. Kyle looks him over.
Who's going to help this? Which one does Kyle Petty get behind? Whoever he gets behind has got a shot to win this race. And here comes a six. He's going to enter into it.
Martin with a good, solid run. He might be able to dip under both of them. All three of them coming up there.
About 5 seconds to pay dirt. Here they come. Urban on the inside.
The shortcut on the inside is going to be of some help.
As they come to the line, dead even.
I don't know. I think like the three. I think Earnhardt won the race. It was awfully close.
Or is this Talladega? Do we do this every time we race up here?
Isn't that something?
Unbelievable to run the kind of race that's been here today and finish it with a few inches.
Give it to Earnhardt. Dale Earnhardt has done it again. At Talladega, the Dega Dominator pulls it off, and the 22 comes across out of gas. Here comes another car out of gas. Jeff Purvis to the line, running out of fuel. Look at this finish.
Look at the four wide on the back, right behind them. Scattered all the way across, trying to get a position there.
And so Dale Earnhardt has done it again. The four-time winner of Talladega, the Dega Dominator, wins it for a fifth here this afternoon. So the 1993 Die Hard 500 at Talladega Super Speedway is over, but the memories here of Davey Allison will live on.
Looking back on the memory of the dance we shared beneath the stars above. For a moment, all the world was right. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? And now it all would end the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance.
Tribute to Davey Allison, a man who drove his first Winston Cup race here, won his first Winston Cup race here at Talladega, Alabama. Let's go to Mike Joy.
Dale Earnhardt rolled in here and he says, that's all it takes, just a couple of inches. How'd you win it?
By a couple of inches. It really is. You know, it was a tough day. Man, it's close racing all day long. Lucky my buddy Neil didn't get hurt. I was thankful for that. He is having a good time, though, and I don't think that scared him any. I think he's ready to go again. But, you know, as Jim Goodrich Chevrolet ran good, and All the guys did a good job. It was just...
Yeah, but how'd you beat Ernie?
I don't know. It was all racing each other. Kyle looked like he got a little loose, and I decided, well, I better go on in front of him, and I got in front of him, and then Ernie and Dale and the rest of them won the races, so I was fortunate to beat them. I got beside with Ernie, and Mark got in there behind Ernie and was trying to push him, and Kyle was behind me, and I had to go back down the bottom and suck off the side of Ernie's car to beat him back just by the inches. That's all it takes.
Great job, Bill. Congratulations.
6-1 of the season, 59 of his career. Here's a better look at that finish.
What he's talking about, a suck off the side of that car. Watch him. He'll pull. He's out high. He said he pulled in right to the side of that car. It gives you just a little bit of pull. And like you said, Ned, it just takes a little bit.
Final standings here today in the Die Hard 500 at Talladega. It's Earnhardt again victorious. Ernie Irvin comes up second. Martin, Kyle Petty, and Dale Jarrett. Greg Sachs came home in sixth. Morgan Shepherd was seventh today. Harry Gant was eighth. Brett Bodine ninth. And Wally Back was tenth. Earlier today, we brought you coverage of the 1993 Tour de France. Indurain was the leader when we left. Now let's rejoin James Brown and Phil Liggett for the conclusion of that race in Paris.